Hey, Kramer, what are you doing?
Oh, hey, Juan. I'm just reading. Okay, it's 50 Shades of Grey, okay? It's my third copy.
Okay. I wasn't saying anything. Yeah, well, third copy? Why third copy?
I may or may not have soiled the first two.
Oh.
It gets me hot and heavy. I'm sorry.
Real hot?
Shit happens, okay? It's a good book.
Whoa. Well, would you like to not ruin all of your copies of 50 Shades of Grey?
Yes, because the pages, like, they get stuck and they tear.
You don't have to say anything else. All you have to do is go to audibletrial.com/shootingblanks. You can get a free 1 month trial and a free audiobook.
That's not bad.
On us.
That's not bad.
It's pretty good.
But what if they don't have 50 Shades of Grey?
I'm sure you'll find something else to jack it to.
Yeah.
You have both hands free now.
Yeah.
Maybe you can do butt stuff.
Oh.
Okay, stop.
Oh.
Stop. Don't touch me. Oh, God. Leave me alone.
Hello. My name is Ryan, and this is the Common Taters Podcast. And this is...
I like how you introduced yourself ahead of time as if you're more important than the rest of us.
Hi, I'm Ryan. This is my podcast. I'm here with some guys.
I never get to do that, guys. Come on.
Welcome to Shooting Blanks Entertainment Presents, the Common Taters Podcast.
Wait, have we started?
I presented it.
Yeah, but your presentation is getting edited out.
I thought you were just practicing.
Man. All right, we're all out of whack.
Let's just go around and introduce ourselves. Ryan last.
Clearly.
No, I went first, bitch.
No, I edited it. I'm going to cut it out.
Just let him go first and then put it last.
Yes, this is exactly what I'm going to do.
But reverse it.
No, please. So it you're too like lazy for that shit.
I'm like, Nyarayr.
Whatever he goes to talk.
We're joined by Satan today. A big fan of the prequels.
Oh, man.
So we are going over, this is the last episode of our miniseries, Kramer the Force Awakens, a.k.a. Kramer Gets Touched by the Force in Inappropriate Places, a.k.a.
Is this the last one? We are going to do one for the Force Awakens.
Oh, no.
The Force Awakens is the last one.
Yeah, the last one is going to be the Force Awakens.
At least for the next year.
Yeah.
And that one's going to touch us all.
I can't wait.
It's like we'll a Force touched, orgy.
And we're all going to be in the same row. Yeah.
A Force G?
A Force G?
I don't want to do this anymore.
So anyway.
I introduced myself. Ryan introduced himself. You guys?
I'm Juan.
I'm Tom.
Sometimes.
Yes. And today, we're going to be going over the prequels.
Woo!
Star Wars. Today's episode is called...
We Kill the Prequels.
1-3, Does George Lucas Hate His Fans?
Yes.
Okay, does anybody want to start off with opening statements about the prequels?
Generalities.
Generalities?
Is that a word?
I didn't want to kill myself all the time.
Not all of it.
Just every now and then.
I'm going to say, as this is my first time watching them, it was not as bad as I thought. Not as bad as I thought it would be.
Okay.
The whole time I was watching it, I felt if I had never seen 4-6,
mm-hmm.
I would have thought 1-3 were pretty good.
Like they're just okay movies?
Like they're pretty good on their
okay
own.
Okay and pretty good are two different things.
I would still say pretty good. But the entire time you're watching 1-3, you kind of compare them to 1-4.
Mm-hmm. Plus, you mean 4-6?
What did I say?
1-4.
Yeah, 4-6. I can't math, I'm sorry. Or count.
That's another podcast. The Math and Counting Show.
But
where it's just Kramer.
It's also the main thing that I think ruins it for the prequels.
On a dry erase board.
Sorry.
They keep projector. Forcing references to 4-6 where they don't need to be.
Also, they missed some references.
Do they?
Yeah.
Go on.
Well, I don't think it was they missed references. I think there were some places where things didn't line up perfectly.
Yeah.
I think the main one that stood out to me was... that Yoda is a good friend of the Wookiees in episode 3.
Yeah.
And when he leaves, he says, goodbye, Chewbacca.
Yeah.
And yet Chewbacca is best friends with Han and starting in episode 4, who doesn't believe in the Jedi or the Force at all. And yet his best friend is like, dude, I know Yoda.
I've seen it. You didn't see Han jump in the back, like in the background?
What?
No, I'm just kidding.
He was like, Chewbacca, did you say something? Who was that green guy?
I don't really see that as an inconsistency with canon or anything like that.
Well, but it's like a forced reference.
No, but that's a forced...
It's a thing that causes a question later on where you're just like, huh, if you're that's a little odd.
But if you're Han Solo and a big hairy creature is all like, I've seen some guy move shit with his mind, you'd be like, no, you haven't.
Fair enough, yeah.
I might take it because he's a giant creature. I bet you've seen weird shit.
He's the skeptic. I mean, he's not gonna.
He probably just looking at Chewie, you cray.
He's probably like, I bet you saw it, but I didn't see it, so it's not true.
No, I think the one that always stands out to me is that Leia said she remembered her mother.
Oh yeah, that's a big one.
When she was very young, and well, no, you didn't. And, apparently, and
you know what? She says she remembered her like birth mother.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. In episode six, right?
Yeah, he asked her, do you remember your real mother? You know, what was she like?
And yet in episode three, it's like right as Padme dies.
Yeah.
Oh, when I called her Panda last time, that's from a robot chicken.
Oh.
When the Palpatine is making fun of Darth Vader, he's like, what, you're going to cry over your dead panda?
Yeah.
He's like, her name is Padme. He's like, whatever.
That's a good skit, whole things.
Especially when he orders lunch. I find that ridiculously hilarious.
That's a good one.
Okay, so starting off with the prequels then, or the very first one.
I think you should explain what you think the plot of the first one is.
What the plot of the first one is?
Like, explain briefly the movie.
Okay, the plot of the first one, as I understood it, is there's some random political bullshit going on between, like, Trade Federation and their boycott of this and that. And what happens is the Jedi go over there. They feel like there's something kind of fucked up. Mm-hmm. And along this little mission to kind of find out what's going on behind the scenes, they find Anakin. And Qui-Gon is like, this is the chosen one. And he basically just brings him along, even though everyone's like, no, he's too old. He can't be a Jedi.
Everyone
like,
says no.
Yeah, and he's like, fuck you guys. I'm going to do it anyway. I'm going to train him anyway.
Qui-Gon's a rebel.
Yeah.
I like Qui-Gon.
He is really Liam Neeson.
Cool. Yeah, that's probably why. I thought he was really good in the movie.
Liam Neeson was the perfect guy for that role.
I wish he wouldn't have died. He was really cool.
Yeah.
But then he had to die so Obi-Wan could ruin
everything. That's true.
That is true. Because it's always been everyone's thinking that if Qui-Gon had gone through what he wanted to do, things wouldn't have turned out the way they did.
They probably still would
in
have.
A way. I think in a way. Like because he was... He would have been a better... master for Anakin than Obi-Wan was.
Yeah.
Yeah, because Obi-Wan had just become a Master Jedi. He probably wasn't ready to have an apprentice yet.
He wasn't even a master at that time. He was just a Jedi Knight. He wasn't a master until the second
Correct.
One?
Yeah, he was a master by the time episode two was.
So that was already like 10 years later. So he wasn't even prepared to start training people, and he did. He had to.
That might be it, too. That's like having a teenager raise like a little kid. Like it's not you don't have all that wisdom ready.
Yeah. But Qui-Gon's so cool.
Yeah, he was a badass. I liked him.
Yeah. I just liked his like.
What did? What?
I don't know. I lost it. I just started thinking how he was like force manipulating everyone, anyone he came after, like in contact with.
He used it all the time.
Yeah, he's like, I want this. They're like, no. I want this.
Okay. It didn't work on...
Except for Watto.
Yeah, Watto. Yeah. It didn't work on him.
Don't work on me. Don't work on me.
I like that guy.
What are you, a Jedi?
That guy is totally an Arabic stereotype, by the way. He's totally like the Middle Eastern mechanic who doesn't want to hear your bullshit.
Yeah. That's totally true.
It was cool seeing him again in episode two, recognizing Anakin.
And he's got hair. He's got like a beard.
Yeah, a little scruff going on.
And
things have been rough.
It's been really bad for Watto.
God damn it.
Sebulba was angry after that pod. Anakin left, so.
God damn it. I didn't like. I know everybody hates Jar Jar Binks.
Yes.
And I think they're right.
That's a great setup.
Like, I remember when I was a kid, I saw Jar Jar and I was like, oh, this guy's funny. And, like, seeing it as an adult, I was telling Juan this. I felt like in the original three movies, C-3PO and R2-D2 were supposed to be, like, the little comic relief that was thrown in there. And since C-3PO hadn't been introduced yet, they decided, like, hey, let's just add some character to be that comic relief, which is what Jar Jar was supposed to be. But it was just terrible.
Too much.
It was just a fucking train wreck.
Too much. That's why I changed. Why I used to like the first one the most, and I changed it mostly because I forgot how annoying Jar Jar was.
Oh, so bad.
I was like, oh yeah, I forgot he's super shitty. But then when I watched it, I was like, I can't watch this. It's so bad. It's making me mad. And that's why now I think the third one is the best one.
And even for, like, it's not like he's from a stupid race of aliens. He's the idiot from that race of aliens.
You know, I still really believe that theory that I read about him.
Boo.
Ooh, should we go about this? Should we go about that now?
I'm just kidding.
Should we explain that theory now or later?
Well, if you want to.
Y'all can do this. I'm not taking this seriously.
Come on, Ryan. Let's talk about
The way that they explain it is it was supposed to go like, you know, Jar Jar was supposed to be a badass. However, during the first movie, like, or after the first movie got released, everyone just took him as a joke. So they were like, fuck, we can't write this guy to do anything real because nobody likes him. So they immediately just turned him to be, you know, an asshole, basically.
They would like, I read too, besides the like theory, was that, yeah, George Lucas was like, Jar Jar's the key to everything. He's like super important to the story. But yeah, because they hated him, they were like, well, we're just going to have to like scale him back. Yeah. And that's why in like 2 and 3, in 3 you only see him. I don't think he even says anything. And
yeah,
in 2,
he's just there briefly.
He greets them.
He hugs everyone.
And he ruins the whole fucking world for everybody.
That's true. And that's it. But it's so brief. Like,
what does he do again?
He gives the Chancellor supreme power.
Oh, okay.
Emergency power.
He's the one who like brings it up in the Senate.
Mm-hmm.
But I also feel like they didn't like. I don't know. Just because the Emperor is such a manipulator,
yeah.
He was like, He's like, we need someone to do this.
Jar Jar is weak-minded.
Yeah, and that's what I was thinking. Like, he's so weak. He kind of like threw that out there, and he was like, if only Padme was here, knowing very well Jar Jar is like in her place right now.
Yeah, and they just look at him after they say
they kind of get the assumption that he's like, oh, I guess I'm gonna have to do this, and then he does it. So, yeah.
Well, fuck. But is the theory is supposed to be like, does it have it tie in with the new movies?
No, you didn't read it.
No, because I hadn't watched the prequels yet.
Oh, I guess scaled back. It basically explains into detail how Jar Jar is, in fact, the Sith Lord and has control over the Emperor.
Secret Sith Lord.
But he sits back as the Emperor's right hand to just kind of be in the shadows and run everything basically faceless.
Yeah. And, like, all his goofiness is just, like, so people don't suspect him.
And there's actually a lot of, like, evidence that makes a lot of sense. As him being, like, a Force user.
Or at least something, like, Force sensitive. Because they're saying that he does a lot of gestures when he's telling people stuff. That maybe he's trying to, like, Force persuade them. And his fighting style is very goofy. It's, like, drunken fists. It's a lot. To me, it's a really, lot of stretches, but it's very interesting.
Well, the way that they explain it is like they explain how all of his movement is calculated, and because everything that he does causes damage. It's not like, oh, I'm just doing goofy things and I'm hurting myself. Like, he's taking out things calculatingly.
What about when I think it's like a mixture of both and both, because like some stuff he does that you're like, oh, he really is like, maybe he knows what he's doing. And then when he's helping fix the pod race, and he's like, they're like, don't touch that. Don't get anywhere near that electrical beam that holds them together. And he's like, okay. Puts my face into it. And it shocks him. He's like, I can't feel my face. And then his arm gets stuck in the blade. And he's just like, don't. They're trying to like pull his arm out. I was like, God damn it, Jar Jar. You're a fucking idiot.
What?
Just pissed me off. I was like, who are you playing that for? Just Anakin there.
Well, you can't let him know anything, especially if he's like...
He wouldn't have known. Anakin's too, like, naive. He's, as a kid, he's just very, like, well, everyone's awesome.
They also went into, like, maybe that Jar Jar veered them to Anakin specifically because he knew.
Oh, that's interesting.
So he's the one that kind of drove Qui-Gon into that direction to come across Anakin because he knew he would sense all the things about him and try to pick him up.
Why did they try to pick him up then? Like Jar Jar and the Sith. I mean, they figured they could have got him as a kid.
Well, because they said they still had to remain like faceless. You know, they couldn't. Nobody even knew who they were. Nobody knew who the Emperor was at all.
That's true. But then Maul makes his appearance. He could have done something. He's the only one that they was like in the forefront.
Yeah, but that dude was clueless about everything. They didn't give a fuck about him.
I thought Darth Maul was badass.
He was, but he was totally clueless to everything that was going on. He was a pawn.
From the
beginning. To be fair, I think everyone's a pawn to the Emperor.
Yeah, of course. Like,
just even except Dooku. Jar Jar. Like,
except Jar Jar.
Fuck Jar Jar.
It's an interesting theory, but I don't think I can get behind it. Maybe if I read it and like a lot more of it stuck to me.
Yeah, it's explained a lot better than how I...
They do have some really good, like... It's very long and there's tons of examples to, like, support it. Mm-hmm. But I think after rewatching it, the only examples they really can pull from is the first movie. Because mm-hmm. then he's not even in the second and third one.
Mm.
What really sold me, though, is when they were talking about when he was jumping off the bridge and the droids were shooting at him.
Mm-hmm.
And they were talking about how he jumped off the left side of the bridge, but he never hit the ground. He caught himself. And a droid shot up to the right, or where he was, you know, because if he's on the left side of the bridge, the droid shoots right to get to him because they're facing this way. Mm-hmm. So the droid shoots right, but then he falls on this side of the screen whenever he jumps down, which they're saying is reminiscent of when Luke, you know, jumped off the side of the little ship thing and then Force jumped his way back up.
Mm.
So.
Well, but he is just, like, his species is more acrobatic, isn't it?
I kind of attributed, well, without knowing this, I've always attributed to, the species before I read anything. Yeah. I just figured that's just is an alien thing. But if it was a human, you would have been like, that guy's a Force user for sure.
But you saw in episode one, you saw an entire army of them, and none of them did anything like that.
Yeah, they really Jar-Jar didn't do too much.
Yeah.
Hmm. Not a single
Although
one of
they
them
were braver than him.
Well.
All of them. Especially when that guy's like, what do we do? And he's like, we can't give up. And he's like, Misa, give up. And he's like, He actually makes that face. I give up.
I give up. What if it was because he knew nothing was going to happen to him?
I guess. I don't know.
If he's working with the Chancellor, okay. Nothing's going to happen to him if he gets caught.
I'm not buying it.
It's because he's so dumb. I believe that, yes, he was supposed to have a purpose. But I don't think it was that far stretched.
I don't know. I believe it.
Because then where do we get that he takes over? Is he still in the background controlling the Emperor in 4, 5, and 6? Like, what were they going to do with that story later on? If he was, like, the puppet master for, like, everything.
Well, I don't think George Lucas was one for your continuity.
Yeah.
Yeah, but they'd have... It would just make people question things more, like,
Well, when he wrote 4, there was never supposed to be another one.
Yeah, that's true.
So he wrote that and just threw it out there and was like, oh, shit, this was amazing. I need to make more, but damn it.
I don't know, but just maybe, I guess the only way, if he was, like, a Sith Lord and they did reveal it in, like, episode 2, Palpatine would have to, like, kill him or something so that there's no Jar Jar in 4, 5, and 6.
Well, and there can only be 2 Sith at a time, right?
Yeah.
It's just supposed to be the Master and the Apprentice.
Yeah.
So if...
And that then Maul would just not be a Sith?
Yeah.
I think in a book, when...
Maul would be killed.
Yeah, in one of these books, I can't remember which one, I remember reading that there was... When Palpatine still had his Master, and there's only supposed to be 2, so it was Plagueis and... Palpatine. Palpatine was training Maul as an apprentice, and Plagueis let it go because of the loophole that he was never be classified as a Sith. He would just be an assassin for them. Mm. Even though he was trained in Sith ways, they never called him a Sith.
Yes.
And that's why they allowed him to have 3 at a time, basically.
That's a thing. That's
interesting. So then that could carry over if Jar Jar was like the Sith Lord. And then it'd be Palpatine. And then Palpatine's assassin would be trained in Sith ways, which could be Maul.
Yeah.
So that would mean that Darth Vader is not technically a Sith.
No, he would be. It's just
Not if Jar Jar is supposed to be the actual master.
Yeah.
And Sidious is supposed to be the apprentice.
Right. But the thing with them is that the apprentice always kills the master.
Mm-hmm.
So at some point, Palpatine would have to kill Jar Jar, and then Darth Vader would be his apprentice, officially.
So there's like a missing chapter where Sidious kills Jar Jar?
If it's true, that's kind of what they would have had to do to keep the story like going.
Mm.
Which could have been possible. I mean, we've never seen it.
Yeah.
It's just he got such a bad reaction. They went overboard with making him too dumb.
Now imagine if Michael Jackson had played him.
Michael Jackson supposed to play him?
Play Jar Jar?
Tried out for it, yeah.
What?
To be in prosthetics and makeup and stuff.
Wow.
Would he have been the one who's talking?
Yeah.
He's not going to save you any. That's all I could imagine. That would be terrible.
That would have been really bad.
Yeah, I'm really glad they did. That would be even a worse Jar Jar.
He would have been dance fighting.
So yeah, George decided
I would have enjoyed the Jance fighting.
Yeah. The Jance fighting?
Jance. Because it's Jar Jar.
So yeah, George decided to do just CGI Jar Jar.
I heard when they did it, they had the actor originally was in some form of prosthetics, and they were going to CGI other parts of him. But then they decided that it didn't look right, so they just full CGI'd like the whole thing.
Hmm. That's the one thing that got me about the prequels was there's not a lot of puppetry or anything.
There's no puppetry.
It's all CGI.
There's not even real stormtrooper suits. Those are all CGI.
Yeah.
Did you watch the episode one that has CG Yoda or puppet Yoda?
Episode one.
Which one did you give him?
Blu-ray copy.
You gave us the CGI one because I know he was supposed to be.
Yeah,
a puppet.
You know, I went back and that puppet doesn't look as good as it did in Return of the Jedi.
You know, I didn't
care. Or Empire.
I liked the CGI Yoda. I didn't mind him at all.
Actually, he's consistent with how he looks
in 2 and 3. So
yeah. No, the CGI was pretty good.
Yeah.
Surprisingly, yeah, the CGI in these movies were really like they didn't hold up, but they were good.
Oh,
like,
I think it held up.
Pretty well.
I liked it's from 99.
I didn't have any complaints about it.
Like, I think the CGI in really 1 good. Was a little bit. It wasn't as good in 2 as it was in 2 and 3.
Mm-hmm.
2 and 3 is definitely better, but that is like I just think a time thing.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It looked good. I expected worse. I guess I expected the CGI thrown into like the original Star Wars. I would just look so bad.
But
it wasn't.
Yeah,
because
that shit is after the fact.
Yeah.
That one just looked too bad. But this one, I was like, everything looks pretty good. I remember even kind of looking closely, like, a lot of these characters have a lot of detail. I'm going to give a compliment sandwich. I'm going to say something nice about Star Wars and then something bad.
You know what's
interesting? Something nice and then something bad.
I actually really like the prequels, to be honest.
No, I do as well.
I went into,
so we're like 50-50 here.
I was telling Kramer, I went into it. I was like, I'm not going to hate on it. I'm not going to do anything. I'm just going to watch it. Like, I'm going to just try to enjoy them again. And I think overall, I did.
Well, on their own, they're pretty good. Especially like in episode one, I love the pod race.
Yeah.
I fucking love that. Like, especially if you've ever played like any of the Jak and Daxter series, there's in 2 and 3, it's very similar. I think like they based it off of like the pod race.
Has he made a Jak and Daxter reference before on this podcast?
Everything. I really like Jak and Daxter.
I was just thinking right now. Kramer references the 4 games he's played. He references Transylvania or Castlevania.
I've played Castlevania.
You talk about the music all the time.
It's good music.
Castlevania, Jak and Daxter, and Final Fantasy and Xenogear.
I didn't mention Spyro the Dragon yet.
Yes, you did.
Have I?
I'm pretty sure you have.
I may have. No, but in Jak and Daxter, they do the because you were mentioning earlier that you didn't like the 3-lap race.
No, I remember when
that you said it went on for a while.
I felt like, only because I kept falling asleep during it. And I watched it really late that I remember thinking this pod race has gone on way too long because I keep falling asleep and waking up and it's still going, and I missed like nothing. I caught the ending and I was like, that's all I needed to see. They get stuck together and then Anakin
wins.
I
think it's suspenseful as hell.
I liked it,
and it's exciting, and it was a great. Harkening back to the on Endor in Return of the Jedi when Leia and Luke were on the speeder bikes.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
And that was well done.
With pod racing, the way I interpreted it was
now this is pod racing.
They're not really like speeders. It's like they're taking actual spaceship engines and
just
putting them on like
them.
On carts.
They're just tethered to engines,
yeah.
Which is,
I remember thinking, how crazy is this?
That's so fucking cool though. Because
it is.
In terms of like speed, that's like a motorcycle. You put a huge ass fucking engine on a little tiny piece of metal and it goes super fucking fast.
Oh, and then did you catch the other homage where Anakin like goes into the sky and then comes back down in front of Sebulba?
Mm-hmm. At the end?
Leia did that. In the speeder bike part where she went up and she came back down
I didn't remember
that.
Yeah. Direct homage.
Well, all right. Pretty sweet. But the pod race was cool. I realized I like Sebulba. He's so dastardly.
Yeah, I like
Sebulba a lot too. He's just the coolest little shit.
The coolest little shit walking on his
We're rooting
like,
for him to kill
legs.
Jar Jar in that one part.
Yeah. I was like, oh man, he's going to kick Jar Jar's ass. Thank God. So he just took his frog.
If we go on to two.
Let's keep talking about.
Calm down. Okay. So
what else is one?
This movie started out with the first act had two Jedi with their lightsabers out, just destroying droids and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It was a clear fan service to like kids.
Yeah.
Because you were talking about how it was the movie where you got excited to have like a lightsaber. The prequels were full of them. Mm-hmm. To the point where having one was just not special.
Oh, the lightsaber action was amazing in the prequels.
It was great. It was.
They sold a lot of toys.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Very choreographed.
Dude, but the choreography was great.
I think my favorite lightsaber battle is actually episode one.
The Darth Maul with the two end.
Oh, yeah.
That was easily badass. Especially when he just pulls it out and like it just the one end turns on first and then the second end
because
turns on.
When he first appears and everyone fights Qui-Gon, going crazy he only has one. He's only using one side. So you're just like, okay, cool. This is awesome.
When he's
going to fight Obi-Wan and Qui-Gon and he pulls it to and there's two blades, you're like, holy shit, it's fucking awesome.
Yeah.
I still got excited rewatching that. I want to say
the saber fighting in the prequels is better than the ones in the originals, like any of the original sword fights.
So you prefer that dance choreography to it? Where
it's not so much a dance choreography. It's much more like if you've ever seen in China, they do a lot of like after martial arts got banned in China, they started a new sport, which is basically like that artistic sword fighting, which is almost exactly what they're doing in the movies. It's very, very elaborate, very showy. But come on, there's swords made out of lasers.
Mm-hmm.
It just looks fucking cool.
And if
you're just going to sit there like fencing style, it wouldn't look as cool.
Yeah. I think I heard it described as, in the prequels, the reason everything's more flashy and stuff because you have people that have been training with these swords since they're a kid. They know how to do all this stuff, whereas in four, five, and six...
There are actual styles that hardcore fans know.
And Luke doesn't know any of this, so that's why they fight more like broadsaber style, like just very heavy-handed, two-handed.
And even then, Darth Vader is more of the broadsword kind of like big knight, the swinging a big sword.
Especially because he's a robot.
Well, he's mostly robot at that point, but like that style is very just like...
He's more machine untrained. Than man.
You're just attacking in the way you've been trained. Whereas, like, in the prequels, they've all been, trained since they were little. So they can flip and do all this badass, like,
stuff. But the thing is Darth Vader was trained in the prequels.
Yeah, but...
But that's the thing.
But
like,
he's now a robot.
As a robot, physically, he can't move as the way he used to be.
Still pretty good.
Yeah, technically, Vader is weaker than Anakin was.
Oh, yeah, of course.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, I think the thing is he loses that mobility that he had before.
I do want to say that I didn't like the acting for Anakin in any of the movies.
Yes.
the kid was okay.
No, he was not.
People hate him the most.
Really?
His first line is, "Are you an angel?"
That was pretty... Well, but he's like, four?
I think his name's Jake Lloyd.
No, he's not.
How old is he in that?
He's like nine or ten.
How old was Padme?
She was like 14-ish, maybe?
Yeah, she's old.
She's a little older.
I remember as a kid, I was just like, she's the same age as she was in Phantom Menace. Like, did he go through a time chamber or something?
I thought in Phantom Menace, because she's already like the queen, I was like, maybe she was like 20?
That was like 10 years later. That was like 10 years later. She was like 25, 26, and he was like 18, 19.
Yeah,
no, but I mean, in Phantom Menace, the first one, I thought she was like 20. Or because she was early 20s. Yeah,
because she is 20. Natalie Portman is.
But then in like the later one, I was like, Anakin's like, what, 17? And then she's like, 30?
He's like,
did you catch that Keira Knightley was her double?
Yes, I did. I did not know that before. I rewatched this now, and I was like,
I didn't know at the time either.
Okay, there was a part where, like...
I thought she did badass.
I didn't catch any of that shit going on when I first saw this movie.
No, as a kid, I was like,
Now that you're mentioning it, I thought Keira Knightley was the actor who played her. And then, like, while I was watching the third movie, I was like, was squinting at the screen. I was like, that's not Keira Knightley. I was like,
took him that long?
Yeah, like, because I didn't know which actors were playing what. Mm. Like, I didn't even realize it was Liam Neeson playing Qui-Gon until I started watching the movie.
I didn't know
like, who was going to be playing who. And so whenever I started watching Padme, I was like, that's Keira Knightley, right? Yeah, that's her. And then in episode three, I was like, that's not Keira Knightley.
The same thing when they show her and got her makeup, I was like, that's not Natalie Portman.
Yeah.
And I kept like, who is that? Decoys. And then like in the background, you could just kind of see her like, she had a little shroud on. You could just see a little bit of her face. I was like, she's in the background.
It's very subtle. They don't like make you notice it at all. And
pretty good.
It's pretty clever for George.
Yeah. Yeah. So then, okay, so the beginning.
Did y'all see any Vaderisms in Hayden's performance?
I mean, I did.
Hayden, that's Anakin?
Yeah.
No, he cried not at a lot. All.
So I don't remember Vader doing that.
It wasn't so much like it was more some of the lines that he chose to give him.
No.
Just.
I think the delivery threw it off.
Big no, time. I see it.
Because every time Darth Vader says something, it sounds like an epic one-liner, like in the originals. In the prequels, it just sounds like I'm watching a kid who listens to too much Fall Out Boy.
There's something wrong with him in episode 2 that I remember just being like, why is he such a baby? Why is he always crying about everything? Like, I don't know. He's just so emotional. But then I guess he's supposed to be emotional so that he can easily turn. But
yeah.
I just it's so like odd. It comes out of nowhere.
I think that's also why I thought he was younger.
Like, what's the matter? He's like, Obi-Wan's jealous of me. He's like, whoa, what? He's done nothing but support you.
I think that's why I thought he was younger, because I was like, he's clearly just going through that teenage rebellion phase.
Yeah, but like way too much. He's supposed to be 18. Like, snap out of it.
I thought he was like maybe 15, 16.
Yeah, if he was younger, fine. But I don't know. I was like, dude, get your shit together, man.
The part where. He dealt with Tusken Raiders was epic.
Oh, okay. I did like that.
And his mom died. He did that part well. In my mind.
No, that was pretty good.
I thought he looked awesome when he was already like turned evil and he had those little glowing eyes and stuff.
Yeah.
When he didn't talk, it was awesome. He looked menacing. He was like being badass, killing everyone.
Yeah. We did see a shot of him like when Yoda was showing Obi-Wan like the
keyboard.
I don't know. If you moved your hands, I was doing like emotions. Like, no.
Like Elton John-ish.
Let's just call it like a videotape of. But it was actually a hologram of him.
Oh, when he was looking at the security tapes?
Fighting other Jedi.
Mm-hmm.
So we know that he was actually taking out more than just children.
Yeah.
In that part.
Oh man, did anybody else when he's like, "But Master Skywalker, there's too many. What are we gonna do?"
I was like,
and he's just like, "You're like, oh."
I looked at him. I was like, "No, Eddie.
No."
Did y'all know that was him in the suit at the end?
No, I didn't.
That was his one time to get to play, to be in the Vader suit.
I know that one part. Yeah, that was the worst like acting I'd seen in the whole thing.
It was enough that he was mad and crushing things with the Force.
Yeah,
like, around him. That's enough.
But
he didn't need to go. No, he could have just been like, I don't know, and just have something like all fall down as he's just like. Breathing and
that's
anger,
why I don't
pain.
Like the no at the that he added at Return of the Jedi.
Oh yeah, because it's the same one.
I hate
it's
it.
Dumb.
I hate it.
But it did give us that button.
It did give us that button. You could press it and go no.
16 O's.
Yeah.
Okay, well, we're skipping around, so we'll
okay.
Go
we'll
back.
We'll go back to still. Let's finish episode one then.
Yeah.
They fight Darth Maul. Darth Maul dies.
Yeah, Obi-Wan got his big no moment.
Oh, yeah.
Homage to
did y'all like... Luke. I realized I didn't like the door, electronic door thing.
I didn't understand what that was.
No, I have no idea what it was for.
Yeah, I don't know the logistics behind it.
You know what? We don't understand space technology.
No, I didn't like it, but I was like, I don't care to know what it is. They don't need to explain it to me. It's whatever.
It could have just been a plot device.
Yeah, it definitely was.
A creative
plot
device.
They show them doing, like, force jumping, force running. Why didn't Obi-Wan? Yeah, they do that really quickly. Him and Obi-Wan just run really fast. Like, it's too fast.
When?
Shit, hold on.
It was at the beginning when the...
It's very brief when they're like, we got to do this. And then they just kind of, like, run. And they speed off, like,
it's when they're cutting through the door. And then they said, bring the droidekas out.
Yes, and they just bolt really fast.
Yeah.
Why didn't Obi-Wan just do the speed run?
I think y'all are seeing things.
No, it's there, Ryan. You didn't rewatch them. That's why. You're going off
I
what you remember.
I know that scene very well. They didn't force run.
Clearly they
did.
Don't.
They force ran.
They just ran.
No, it was force
that.
Running.
They,
it was force
they
running.
They made it look like it was force running. It was that sped up. Like,
it was like...
It was unnatural. No. They showed them running the whole movie. Like, this one was clearly like sped up.
Why
it's the same thing when they do their like super long
why
jumps.
Would such a subtle thing like that not be used again, though.
It's my point. Why wouldn't they do that again?
Because George Lucas hates his fans.
No, because that's it doesn't exist.
It does exist. It's got to exist. They showed it. Why else wouldn't they do it again?
That the world has become just so expansive that people forget things as they're writing.
You could also attribute that to a bad cut or something.
No. Because they're also like, where'd they go?
And it makes sense that if they can do that, they're showing how they can like force jump and all that stuff too. Why wouldn't you assume that if they showed it, they don't have to explain everything they're doing?
I do think
they would just do it, right?
I do think that when the fission door opened, or all of them opened for Obi-Wan, and he started sprinting, the first one closed just conveniently too quickly, you know? Because it lasted longer the first time around.
He could have force sprinted the whole way. But I know what you're saying because I remember thinking the same thing, like, that shouldn't have closed as quickly as it did.
Yeah, no, that's convenient, you know.
I like the drama it added to it, actually.
That's over here.
It'd
be very directed.
It was the thing with Obi-Wan and, not Obi-Wan, Qui-Gon. I also got the feeling, like, he knew he wasn't going to make it out once he started, like, meditating a little. Mm-hmm. But then I was like, maybe he's just calming himself for the battle.
That I attributed to be, like, the two sides of, like, the dark side and the light side?
Yeah.
Is when, like, you know, they have that moment in a fight where, like, there's a pause. The Sith is just walking back and forth, like, pacing.
Angry,
and then,
right?
Qui-Gon is just collecting his thoughts.
Being
and
calm.
Like, yeah, he's, like, calming himself because he knows he has to stay, like, at peace for the fight.
He's like, all right, how am I going to do this? It doesn't work.
Loosen it up.
It doesn't work.
But I do, like, as soon as the door, like, moves, he's instantly up, swords out, like, really quick. Like, he's ready to go. So I do like that.
And the less experienced Obi-Wan is sitting there. He's not pacing, but he's still like tense.
He doesn't know what to do yet. And in that weird second, he loses that little bit of time.
Man, that part where he takes out Qui-Gon and Obi-Wan goes to confronts him is... That choreography was awesome.
And he's mad.
Because he didn't do any cuts. He just held the shot of them, you know, doing their thing. Mm. And it looks
I like when Obi-Wan's hanging down on that hole in the ground. And Darth Maul's just slicing the top, just hitting it back and
sparks, a bunch of sparks.
Just sparks. He's just smacking the ground with the sword. I was like, that's so cool.
That was pretty cool.
He's just waiting for him. He's like, fuck you, man. They shouldn't have killed Darth Maul. He was so cool.
He was cool.
They didn't.
I know he lives, but...
Another reason to watch Clone Wars.
What? Wait, what?
It's another reason to watch the Star Wars The Clone Wars.
I'll tell you, Kramer. I'll ruin everything.
I'm kind of like happy, but also like what?
Like I said, Clone Wars makes everything better.
Okay, I'm gonna have to watch Clone Wars. It is canon?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But I kind of know a little bit about what they do with him too, and I still don't like it. He either should have just lived completely or just died.
He's still alive.
But I'm saying they should have just kept him dead. Or
you don't like what they did with him?
No, I didn't.
Well, why?
Because, I don't know, I saw especially one particular clip where, okay, he's living, and him and his brother, I think it's his brother, Savage. Whatever.
I don't know why they say, no, I don't know why they want to say
it's
Savage.
It's spelled Savage.
It should be, is it Savage?
Oppress?
Yeah. I like that better than Savage.
Savage Oppress?
Savage sounds like a woman's name.
Savage.
Sausage.
I don't know,
anyway,
Savage.
His material is great in the show.
I saw that and I was like, cool. And then I saw when the Emperor meets back up with them and just bitch slaps both of them. Darth becomes such a like bitch at the end. And I was just like, that's not quite how I remember him in the movies. He was a little more menacing.
In the movie? He didn't do anything.
He
in
was
the movie.
More menacing. No. And then he gets on his back and he's about, and the Emperor has him like cornered and he's like, don't kill me, please, Master. Oh, please don't kill me.
No, yeah,
he's,
I don't like
he's
that.
Crying, he's groveling, just and the Emperor's it. Like, I won't kill you, I have plans. And I'm like, why bring him back for that?
I don't agree with you,
Ryan.
I don't agree with you.
That was a bad choice.
You haven't watched it all.
I saw enough. I saw that.
No, there is no such thing as I saw enough to judge something.
I saw the ending. Why is he groveling?
You haven't watched it.
It's because he's weak now. He's weak.
Yes, he was. His power was literally cut in
half. Then they
shouldn't
have brought him back. They should have just kept him dead or made him be a badass like up until at least the third one. And maybe they wouldn't have had to bring in Dooku. They could have still had Grievous.
I like
but then Anakin,
I like Dooku, though.
I like Dooku a lot.
Anakin could kill like Maul or something if they decided.
No, I like the way that Dooku goes out. I like Dooku's character.
Oh, the way he dies?
And the way, do it.
I love Dooku's fighting style. Like, in the sense that he's, like, the way he holds his lightsabers and stuff is very, like, you can't see what I'm doing, but, like, weird.
And his lightsaber
he does, like,
curved.
The fencing style.
Yeah, like he has, like, the... It's very classy. Like,
I don't
very...
like his lightsaber. Whenever the toy it's all, came like, out. Bended? Yeah, when the toy came out, I was like, that's stupid.
it's a weird, but, like, the way he uses
it's a limp wrist style?
Yes, it really is. He does kind of, like, have that limp wrist, like...
He fights like a Frenchman.
Yeah, it's weird, but
yeah,
it's...
Yeah, like fencing. Right, yeah. Like musketeers.
Yeah.
It's so classy, though. It looks so classy. Like, I feel like when he fights, it's very, like, he's an expert duelist. He doesn't need to expend too much energy. He can just turn the back of his hand, and because of the shape of his lightsaber, can kind of, like, still block something. Or he can hold it in, like, almost a weird way, and it still works.
Now, I don't remember the specifics, but did he say he trained Qui-Gon?
Yes.
Yes.
He was Qui-Gon's master.
He was Qui-Gon's master.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's
cool. And Yoda was his master?
Yes, I think so. Yoda trained Dooku, Dooku trained Qui-Gon, Qui-Gon Obi-Wan.
I think it's up in the air whether or not he was directly his master.
Well, Yoda trained, I thought they mentioned it in episode 2.
I think he does mention that it is, that's his master.
Like that's, okay, yeah.
Yeah.
And then, because everyone says Yoda's the master,
well, Yoda,
he's my master.
He trains all the little kids, too, from what it looked like, so I guess in a sense he's
not his main master.
He's everyone's master at some point.
Yeah.
I do like the line in episode 2, is it?
Mm-hmm.
And he was like, if you keep that, you'll be as good as a swordsman as Master Yoda. And Anakin goes, I thought I already was. And Obi goes, simmer down.
Like, come on. He's so cocky.
Yeah.
And he has, well, he can back it up a little until he gets to, like, Dooku, and Dooku just chops his arm off.
Oh, the part with episode 2? Because I know everybody was saying that a lot of people say it's their favorite. A lot of people say it's their least favorite.
Juan and I are giving each other a look. Like
who says
everybody
that?
Says
not
a lot of people say
not in this group.
No, not in like,
no, like Adrian.
You don't really
I've known a couple of other people, and it's mostly like they're a couple years younger than us. So I'm assuming it's mostly the crowd
it's
that started
Phantom
with the prequels.
Phantom Menace. Like they were just at the right age that when
maybe,
that second one came out.
I can imagine it because the third act is a great payoff for how much that you trudge through the.
Oh, yeah, the fight scenes
of episode 2.
The fight scenes are the best fight scenes I think out of all 6 movies.
In 2?
The first
the war scene?
In 3.
Oh, okay, so the battles.
Yeah, the battles and then all the Jedi coming out all at once.
Yeah, that's great. Oh,
that's
three,
epic, isn't it?
No, that's 2.
That happens at the end of 2. When they're in the Colosseum.
Oh, yeah, that Colosseum scene and then the war that happens or the battle that happens after that is fucking great.
Jango Fett.
I like the also in part 2, speaking of him, I like Obi-Wan being like a Batman detective.
Yeah, that
was
cool.
The one
really cool.
He found the clones.
Tracking down everybody. Mm-hmm. I hated Dexter Jester in his weird 50s diner.
Oh,
he was kind of weird.
Yeah.
I was like, why is there a 50s diner in Star Wars?
Obi-Wan.
They don't even have the 50s.
Obi-Wan, my old friend. My old friend.
That sounds a lot like him.
So
weird. That was kind of weird.
Oh, yeah. Man.
That was totally like a noir film kind of style. The diner and the way he goes looking around for him.
Actually, I've heard that's kind of intentional.
Yeah.
That a lot of Star Wars is very old timey on purpose. Mm.
Just weird. There's a 50s diner in Star Wars. That's a little odd. I'm pretty sure the lady was like, "What can I get you, hon?"
Instead of like, can I get you a coffee? She says, get you a, I don't know what the fuck they drink.
Whatever, kind of drink.
Can I get you a blue milk? Or
I get you some blue milk. Disgusting.
Episode 2 is also the second time we saw Obi-Wan going into a bar.
Oh, yeah.
You know, because it's Ben. He went in there and knew the layout. And
why didn't
can
the
I sell you some death sticks? You do not want to
you
sell
do
me
not
death sticks. I don't want to sell you death sticks. You're going to go home and rethink your life. I'm going to go home and rethink my life.
He just changed that guy's life for the better.
It's so weird.
I got home and was like, he's right. What am I doing? I'm going back to school.
What do they call it? Death sticks?
Death sticks?
I'm going
death
back to community sticks. College on Tatooine.
Oh, my God.
I used to be a civil engineer.
Tatooine, right?
Yeah, this civil engineering Tatooine, they have to have irrigation systems. It's a desert planet. They need the water.
What were you going to say? Someone was about to say something about the shapeshifter.
Oh, the assassin. She runs it. They chase her around the city, which is very long, a little overdrawn, but still okay. Mm-hmm. First of all, I laughed really hard when Obi-Wan just jumps out of the building when the robot is delivering those poisonous slugs. Yeah. He just bolts through the glass.
That was great. I love that part.
Like Batman.
I was like, what the fuck, Obi-Wan?
Yeah, that is Batman-ish.
Oh, man, it was so funny.
That scene started and ended well. Yeah, I think it was like when Anakin took the different route.
I laughed so hard, but he jumps out and he grabs that. And then Anakin does a similar thing later. He just jumps off the thing and he's like, oh, Anakin, I hate when he does that. I don't know. Like, I hate when he jumps out the window. Fun flying robots. But anyway, so yeah, they chase her. It's kind of a long chase, but
it took a little while.
Yeah, a little too long. But other than that, they corner and she goes into the bar, and Obi-Wan's like, "What's okay? She's going in there to hide. Let's find her. She's a shapeshifter." But when they do find her,
she's the same.
Why wouldn't she just shapeshift into something else and casually walk out?
Maybe he's wrong.
Because it's fucking dumb.
She's like, no, it's a regular person.
I'm just going to be the same. I'm the only person in some kind of masked armor still. I'm just going to walk in casually and I can sneak up on this Jedi because I'm good. I'm a good assassin. And then as soon as she gets close, turns around, chops the arm.
Yeah, maybe she thought she could take him out.
I don't.
Oh, that's another homage. He takes out someone's arm, someone's hand in the bar.
Yeah.
No blood this time.
True.
See, those are the good references.
Fucking violent. Remember thinking that's. Well, anyway, yeah. Go on.
I like the good references, like you're saying, the homages. Those are awesome.
And I have a bad feeling about this.
Every movie.
Multiple times.
Uh-huh. Those are good. The whole random, let's bring a character from the original three movies and randomly throw them into a spot in the prequels. That didn't set well with me.
What?
The Chewbacca one was the main one. The fact that C-3PO was built by Anakin.
I was going to get to that.
Later. Yeah, I was like, that seems like a bit much for me. And then, the whole time I was questioning it, in the first two movies, I was like, how the fuck does C-3PO not recognize Tatooine or any of that shit? But then at the very end, they're by the way, wipe C-3PO's memory.
Yeah, wipe his mind. He's like,
And why?
Did they also wipe Obi-Wan's mind? Because in episode 4, he's like, I don't recall ever owning a droid. And C-3PO and R2-D2 are right there. He spent 20 years with them.
That's a good point.
Staying in the ship, R2, how many times did he say that?
Yeah, like I said, weird inconsistencies.
See, that's stupid. That's stuff that makes me mad. Why would they do that?
I didn't even think about that part. Which means R2-D2 is the only one who remembers everything.
No, that's true.
No, he also has convenient amnesia because he never uses his jetpacks again.
He does have a lot of, R2-D2.
And his little arms. His little arms that come out of the little blue parts on him. There's little arms. He never uses that again.
And does he use the spitting oil again?
No, I don't think I've seen he does that either.
Like when he took down those two battle droids by spitting the oil and then lighting up fire.
When he gets shot, he starts flailing.
Oh, he flails them out.
Love that sound.
Man, yeah.
Okay, but so in episode 2, the action was great.
You know, a single clone trooper armor was created for this film.
Yep.
Or these films.
It was all CGI.
All of them were CG.
It looked pretty good, though.
It looked okay.
Yeah, I didn't know.
I didn't have any complaints. I remember thinking that, looking really hard and be like, you can tell it's a little CGI, but they did a really good job.
Yeah.
All the non-action parts of episode 2.
Boring.
Bullshit.
Jesus Christ.
The romance.
The romantic part.
The romance was so bad. I love that the whole time Anakin's like, I love you. And she's like, yeah, you're just a kid, Annie.
I remember, you're just a kid, but
then she still falls in love with him, despite the fact that he's a little shit the whole time. I was like, he does nothing that seems like a grand romantic gesture. He basically just disagrees with all of her ideologies and bitch about his master.
There is a great part about where she calls him a Padawan and not a master. And he gets his feelings hurt about it. He's like, hold on a second.
What do you mean?
Oh, no, I'm out of security here, guys.
I'm in charge. I thought that was funny too when she recommended to go back to Naboo, and he was like, "I don't think we should do that. I'm in charge here, blah blah." She's like, "I don't care. I'm the queen, blah blah blah. You're supposed to follow me, remember?" And he's like, "Okay, yeah, you're right." He kind of gets a little smile, like, "You're right," but he was so angry before.
I think it's because she was like, "By the way, I'm going to a lake house." He was like, "Okay, yeah,
I'll get my dick wet. I'm going to a lake house." He's so creepy in that movie.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, she goes for it. Obsession.
She goes for it so quickly.
You know what? I was watching it with Daisy, and I remember telling her, like, is this guy's really creepy? Like, why is he so creepy? And she was like, yeah, he's really weird, but maybe she goes for it because since she's also not supposed to have, like, any kind of relationships, this is someone who actually is, like, pursuing it, and she kind of likes it because it's so different. No one is willing to, like, even talk to her in that same way, and he's so upfront about it. And it's very taboo, so she's kind of like,
I think this. In terms of, because she is a politician, I'm pretty sure she gets, like, a whole bunch of, like, debutante sex slaves?
Well, I don't know.
No, like, it's basically, like, not a debutante word. It's like high class. They go to, like, a lot of formal things, and they get to meet a bunch of other high class people. Mm-hmm. And so chances are she meets, like, a lot of governors and people, and they're like, oh, you're a cute little senator. I imagine that happens a lot. Maybe it's...
Old men?
Could be,
Old men.
Old alien men.
Because, like, they get raised from a very young age to be politicians. Like her, she is basically raised to be a politician. So imagine...
No, she was, like, she way was too queen. Young. She was way too young to do what she was doing.
Yeah, but she was even mentions that when she was younger that they were in... she went to school... For that, like, they raised her from a young age to be a politician.
Well, yeah, that was just her specifically, though.
So you think because most of the other people aren't like that either?
No, because she is queen. When you look at the Senate, they're all old. She's the only one that's that age.
Well, I don't know. She's such a powerful, like, person. I can't imagine people would want to, like, hit on her too much because she's gonna be like, "Are you fucking hitting on me, the queen?" And they'd be like, "You're right. Nope.
No, you're right. Nope."
Well, but she's not the queen anymore at that point.
No, she's not the queen, but she's still someone of very high power.
Yeah.
Especially on the boot.
And by that point, she's taken.
I mean, just that fact is very, like, intimidating to a lot of people.
Mm.
So I don't know. Maybe she saw, like, Anakin's not intimidated by
this. Maybe it's because she didn't have that childhood, like, high school romance.
That could be it, too, yeah.
And she's high school age?
She just went for it. She was like, fuck it.
Yeah.
I think I like him. He's weird. I'll change him.
And his little, like, that fucking hairdo that he had.
Oh, yeah.
He had Obi-Wan's old hairdo.
Yeah, he did.
That one thing. Yeah. I didn't understand. I was like, is that supposed to be a Padawan thing?
Or they just follow up with the Master. Then that means Obi-Wan should have had some long-ass hair going on.
Oh, yeah.
That Qui-Gon had.
Yeah.
He's getting there.
Well, the braid thing is a Jedi.
He'll get there.
The braid thing is a Jedi thing eventually.
Yeah, the braid's a Jedi trait. Because Qui-Gon had one. Obi-Wan had one.
Mm. What'd you say?
The braid?
Yeah.
Padawan braid?
Yeah.
Because
Qui-Gon had long hair, but he had a braid in it.
Okay.
It was very distinctive. It was off to the side.
Okay, yeah, I do remember that.
But, yeah, I think that's just a Jedi thing.
I'm thinking of, not of what we're talking about, but, like, I started thinking about the Count Dooku Yoda fight.
Mm-hmm.
Did y'all like that fight?
Yes.
I went crazy in the theater when Yoda walked up.
Yoda was a fucking badass.
He dropped his cane, and I was like...
You know what I didn't like, though, which I laughed at? I was like, Count Dooku. I don't blame him. This is just bad script writing. Well, first, where they're using the Force against each other. Count Dooku's raising things off, and he's throwing it to Yoda, and Yoda's moving it and blocking it, and he's like, well... I guess we cannot fight using our powers of the Force. We must have a lightsaber duel. And then I was like, you didn't have to say it, Count Dooku. Just do it. Just pull out your lightsaber. Why are you talking like that? It's just so awkward. It made me laugh so much.
I thought that line was all right.
I thought Christopher Lee did that fine.
Huh?
His name's Christopher Lee. I think he did that fine.
Christopher Lee was pretty good. I like Christopher Lee. But I remember just being like, just fight him. You don't have to tell him.
I do like that Yoda is, like, one of the only people that can, like, block the lightning.
The lightning?
Oh, that was so good.
He looks so funny when he does the lightning. I think anyone, he looks funny because they just raise their fingers out like, But, it, like, Dooku looks funny because his arms are very straight and he keeps his, like, fingers pointed up. Kind of like, I don't know. He makes funny faces like... They just told him, just do that. He's like, okay. Just throw lightning. It looks really, like, stiff when he does it. Just kind of like, his arm is very stretched out. And
it did throw me by surprise because I thought Darth Sidious was the only one who could use the Force lightning. So seeing that Darth Tyrannus could do it too was pretty cool.
Yeah.
I want to see pre-edit footage of that.
He's just like,
There's nothing coming out of his hands. He's just like.
Which also means because he was fighting Yoda. He's not really fighting anybody.
No.
He's just running around a room pointing his hands at like empty space.
He only did one hand.
It wasn't even him, too. It was like, I'm sure it was like a stunt double who was just waving the lightsaber in the air, like pre-production wise.
Oh, yeah.
It was awesome to see Yoda.
No way Christopher Lee could do all those stunts.
It was awesome seeing Yoda overwhelm him.
Yeah, as it should.
Just jumping around him, circling him.
Which is why I was like, it's very like in character. He's like, fuck it. I'm going to try to squish Obi-Wan. And then he uses that to escape.
I think it's
Obi-Wan and Anakin.
I think it's really cool that Yoda, he walks around with a cane because physically he can't really do a lot. But when he fights, it's just him using the Force to throw himself around.
Yeah,
it's not like he has giant jumping powers or anything like that.
Well, I know people who don't like that fight because they're like, why is Yoda spinning and jumping around? But it makes sense because how else is he going to fight? He's so small.
Yeah.
He needs some way to attack people bigger than him.
But it makes sense if he's using the Force to maneuver him his own self around. Yeah,
because he's supposed to be a master Force user. He should be able to use it in everything.
You know who was a bitch in that fight? Obi-Wan. He's got touched twice on the leg. Once on the leg, once on the arm.
Yeah.
Got taken down.
He's lucky he didn't lose any hands.
He didn't lose shit. They probably just grafted some more skin onto that shit.
Mm-hmm.
Anakin lost a hand.
Anakin lost an arm.
I didn't realize he didn't get his... There's no skin ever put onto that arm. Mm-mm. It just stays a robot arm the whole time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I like that. For some reason, that technology advanced. As time went on.
I bet he was looking back like, oh, man, I'm stuck in this suit.
What was that gold robot hand he had when he married Padme?
Yeah,
looked so weird.
His robot hand. I kept thinking, she has to touch that. It's so cold.
Oh, that has to touch her.
Yeah. Just feel something metal just moving down you.
I just imagine they're making out and the human hand is touching her and then the cold part comes and she's like,
She thinks the T-1000 is there. With
Or he just wears the glove all the time, so it's just like rubber.
That'd be better, I think.
Hey, I'd probably just put on the glove. That's weird. I like that fight. I liked Count Dooku on his little speeder when he was escaping. I don't know why I liked that so much. He just
and then Mace Windu coming into the fight for the first time, seeing his purple lightsaber. Fucking Samuel L. Jackson.
He asked for that too.
Yeah, he had to.
No, he did. He was like, I want a purple one.
I love that so much. Whatever.
He's also got motherfucker.
Does he have
motherfucker inscribed on the lightsaber?
Oh, that's cool.
He probably owns that thing.
I bet. That's awesome.
I would too. Shit.
Hell yeah. That's pretty cool. Did anyone else not feel, even though the fight was really cool when the clones get there and the droids and all the Jedis are fighting, did you not feel as much tension in the fight as previous fights, with Obi-Wan and stuff? No?
You mean when the cavalry arrived?
Yeah.
Well, I think that was... I mean, they were the cavalry, so it
I kind of
felt like...
I felt like I didn't, care it felt about like the fight. Well, it looked really nice, but I didn't care, because there's no stakes. It's clone versus droids.
It felt like the tension was supposed to, deflate from that, because...
I think so. It was more like... It wasn't that there was supposed to be tension, because the clones just completely overrun everything.
Yeah.
It's not even a fight at that point. It's just a slaughter.
Yeah, they were awesome.
They were cool. But, I remember just thinking, I'm not as, even though it looks good, I'm not as interested in this fight because there's too much going on.
No, I love all the shit that was going on.
No, I liked looking at it. It looked cool, but it wasn't interesting. I really preferred the one-on-one fights like Dooku versus Obi-Wan.
Yeah, I would say
that. Those ones, because I feel like those had stakes. Mm-hmm. And this one, it was clone army who's expendable, droid army expendable. And they're just shooting each other.
Well, it's kind of like in Lord of the Rings, whenever they have the huge forces and the giant armies coming after each other.
Yeah.
It's showy, but it's not really you can't pinpoint I like how that one guy, number 526, swung his sword over. If you look at the corner and you zoom in over there, he did this cool move. And it's just meant to be a lot of overwhelming action in the background.
Speaking of that, that style, I mean, not that style, but what you just said, I really kept following the guy with the fish face in the background because I did like the way he fought.
The fish face?
Yeah, you know what I'm talking about, right?
Does he have tentacles?
He's got tentacles.
Yeah.
What's his name? Kit Fisto?
Kit Fisto, yeah.
Kit Fisto? I liked him because I would watch him. I was like, actually, I like him fighting. I would just watch him being a badass.
He's in the he's in
and
the
at some point he pushes away some droids and he makes this little smile. Oh, like
was he the he had like the
he pushes on to
3PO yeah
droid yeah
and he makes a little smile
with
like
the two so tentacles cool. And he's got the big eyes
yeah, big black eyes. He was cool. I kept watching him.
I've always liked Plo Koon's design.
Which one was
Plo Koon? Yeah, Plo Koon was cool.
He, the orange alien with like a he looks like he, he's like a bug face.
In the episode two game, you can play as Plo Koon.
Yeah, he's in a bunch of video games.
I don't remember which one he is. I'd have to see his picture.
I have to go back and learn the names of all these.
Sorry.
Oh, fine, let's see it. Whip it out.
I have to learn the names of all these characters.
Plo Koon had the orange lightsaber, right?
He used to. How'd you say, Kramer? That used to be a thing, but I think it's just he's just got a blue one, officially.
Oh, yeah, I like the orange one.
Yeah, me too.
Ryan's trying to show you.
Okay, yeah, throw it to me.
Throw you the...
Ah. Oh, it went away. Plo Koon.
Plo Koon.
Okay. Kind of remember him.
Yeah.
He's both vaguely, him, though. Both him and Kit Fisto have good size like roles in the Clone Wars.
Mm.
They're actual characters.
I like that they had a large variety of like the Jedi.
I also like the guy who looked like a wonton.
Like a wonton?
He was in the council and he had a really long kind of face. And he had like little things in the middle of his face.
Oh, the big ass forehead.
Like creases.
Oh, yeah.
He looked like a wonton.
Kiata Mundi, I think.
Yes, that's his name.
His big forehead dude with
the white beard. Got the white beard.
Yeah.
A point
yeah.
down here and a point up
that's
here.
That's the guy who stuck out a lot to me. I liked his character.
I was like, he looked like a wonton.
They put him pretty center screen, so he stood out.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. He was in the council, and
they're just like, look they show at this him
die.
Guy.
Oh, I did get sad when they showed him like die when the clones turn.
Yeah,
yeah.
Oh man, like Plo Koon died. He's like, come on. We saw him die as well. And then he turns, and they're not moving. He's just like, oh shit! And then they just start firing. He's blocking, and then they shoot him, and they keep shooting.
Dude,
him.
That like, whole fuck. Sequence of like all those Jedi dying, I was like, no.
I think that's why I like 3 so much because it was so much. It was so bad. I was like, oh my god, they're killing everyone.
3 was dire.
Except yeah. Yoda. Yoda fucking sensed it immediately. As soon as they turn, pacha, 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 heads off.
And then his Wookiee friends are like, oh shit, we gotta get out of here.
They're like, yeah, we should go, huh?
Yeah, Obi-Wan just got lucky.
At the end of that,
he got so lucky.
Were the Wookiees wiped out?
No.
Because it looked like the clones at the end, they were walking around and they're like, no, these Wookiees are already dead. And then they like were running off on those like robotic walker things. I think they were looking for Yoda. Is right when Yoda left.
I don't know if they would have killed the Wookiee. They imprisoned them. We find out later on in Rebels.
Okay.
But I don't know if they would have killed them because the whole point of spreading the Republic out and recruiting planets for the war, for their side of the war, was so that at the end of the day, that was all the control that the Emperor was going to have.
Yeah.
All those planets and stuff. So the Wookiees would have just been.
I think maybe it was just weird the way they worded that scene.
Mm.
Or the way it was played out, because it looked like they were looking and they're like, oh, these Wookiees are already dead. And I was like, wait, are they looking for Yoda or are they trying to wipe out the Wookiees?
Actually, when I saw that, I wasn't sure what they were even looking for. I figured, I don't know if I missed that.
Maybe,
I was like,
maybe it was Yoda.
I don't think I could hear what they were saying. I was like, what are they looking for? And they just kind of left. I think I expected like Obi-Wan to come out of there and he didn't. I was like, oh, I don't know who they're looking for then.
I was expecting Yoda because like they... Like you said, Yoda actually like knew that they were gonna, or he sensed that they were gonna about to attack him, so he wiped them out.
Yeah.
But the clones are still like, oh shit, where's Yoda?
Well, he sensed all the Jedi dying right before that.
Yeah.
He was just like,
that was
oh, kind of
cool.
Oh,
where
shit.
He's like, he just grabs his heart and he's like, oh,
yeah.
Fuck.
Yep.
So sad.
Millions, maybe not millions, thousands of voices cried out.
Feels.
I like when the clones turn though, and they're like, execute order 66. And they're all just like, they give each other a signal, like, yep. And they're on speeder bikes, and they all slow down, and they're shooting that one. Yeah. Or they're at that weird planet, and they shoot that girl in the back, and they just keep shooting her. She's, like, on the ground. They're just...
Oh, yeah.
Everyone's slowly turning. Man.
At first, I was like, how are the clones just going to go with this? But then I remember, like, in the Clone Wars, they're talking about how, like, they're made to be more passive to orders.
Yeah, like, they literally have a chip in their heads.
Oh, okay. Fuck.
Yeah, that was crazy. And then at the same time, Anakin's going around, and he's got stormtroopers behind him, and they're going into the temple, and he's just killing.
Mustafar was cool.
Yeah, the planet?
Yeah, like the lava planet.
Mm, I like
cool.
That.
It was very... I don't know if it's cliche, but
yes,
to have their final battle on that kind of planet, you know, where it was just
it had to be explosive
and yeah,
it was. Epic. I really enjoyed that fight.
I think that fight went on a little too long. Like, by the time they were floating on those bots in the lava, I was like, okay,
there was a,
you know, wrap it up.
There was a couple scenes that I felt like they didn't need. Like, when it jumped back to them, and all of a sudden they're just balancing on that long
the rope
rod thing, and they're not even fighting, they're just balancing.
Yeah,
I'm like, what are they doing? How did we get there? And then they just jump off, and I'm like, oh.
But it helps that they're intercutting with Yoda and Sidious.
Yeah.
So that
it awesome. Makes yeah. it go. I like the fight a lot, especially when they're floating and Anakin's eyes are like yellow now, and
yeah.
he's giving in big time. It's good.
The part about Mustafar that I really liked, and I guess it's not so much about the storyline as it is just the way the world is set up, is that you can tell it's a reactor that's stabilizing the planet. Mm-hmm. So that they can mine ores out of the lava.
Mm-hmm.
And because, like, while they're sword fighting in the control room, they hit something, the reactor is no longer able to control the eruptions on the planet.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so all the volcanoes go crazy. And I was like, that's pretty fucking cool.
Yeah, very briefly they show you that you can see there's a shield around
what
the thing, and they cut to it, and it just, you can see it turn off, and then they cut away from it. So they basically tell you that, and it's really cool.
Yeah, and the planet's like no longer stabilized anymore.
Yeah.
So it's basically like a nuclear reactor going off.
Can you believe it's all CGI? I mean, it looked great.
It looked really good.
I can believe it, but, no. But it looked good. Yeah, you're right.
Shut up, motherfucker. You know what I mean.
You're like, wait, that wasn't a lava planet?
How much did they pay them to be in that lava?
Oh, my God. No, it looked great, though, especially the
they filmed that in, they
the falling they filmed that in chunks. Hawaii. And,
yeah. This is cool. But you know what? I wish they would have shown a better way or made up a better way to have his legs and arm cut off and stuff. And they're like, he's like, when Obi-Wan's like, Anakin, don't do it. I have the higher ground. And he's like, you underestimate me. I'm going to do it. And he does it. And he's just like,
I'm going to do it.
Don't you do it. I thought he was going to like fall into lava. And that's how like his legs get cut off. Or like they don't get cut off. I thought they were literally just going to be like, what is it? Burnt off? Lava'd off?
Yeah.
Something. I don't know. I think that it's a little more impactful, the fact that Obi-Wan struck the blow.
That day. I like that he
and
did that.
And then watched him burn to
I wish
near
it would
death.
Have been a little more, because it was very anticlimactic. That's after all of their fighting, one stupid flip and he's gone.
Yeah.
It should have been like maybe he tried to like kick him away and Obi-Wan chopped off a leg. Or something.
I don't know. That I don't know.
Maybe,
sound great to me.
Maybe as they're fighting, I'm just spitballing. As they're fighting each other, maybe that's when he does the flip and gets caught in with his legs chopped off. But that far away flip that he knew he wasn't gonna make, and Obi-Wan was like, "Don't do it," and then he does it. And he's like, "Okay." It was very anticlimactic. If they would have been fighting and he flipped, like every other fight where they're fighting really hard, and then all of a sudden the arm gets chopped off.
I can see
that's cool. But like, I wish they would have done a little more like. Clothes, like guess, like that. But when he is watching him, just like what? Starting to catch fire, that was cool. It's brutal.
Can we talk about General Grievous?
Yes.
What
General
the
Kenobi?
Kenobi. What the fuck is he supposed to be? I was like, when he first started coughing, I was like, does that android have like cancer? I don't understand what's going on.
He's and cyborg, then, right?
It shows that he has like organs and stuff, but.
You can see under his mask when they do that close up.
Yeah, there's
that
a face. Like
he was originally originally an organic being.
Okay.
And then he went through a process to become what he did, what he was.
Okay. Because at first I thought it was just an android.
And he did it willingly.
Okay. I really did like that how he had like a collection of lightsabers.
Oh yeah.
And he was like
four already.
And Count Dooku showed me how to use these, and he's like, and he starts off, and like the two hands just start spinning. And it looks like just a fan of lightsabers. And
I was
like,
how did Dooku teach him to do that?
Like, they're just cutting along, like, the floor and, like, melting the floor.
That's a good lightsaber battle as well.
Yeah.
Because you see Obi-Wan, but like, shit, I'm kind of looking at all four.
But
like,
he times it perfectly.
Sees through it, you know.
I think...
He's good enough to like, see through his weaknesses.
Obi-Wan's good. I think he shouldn't have won, or at least got damaged in that fight. Because Grievous has four arms. At times when he was blocking two, the other arms weren't doing anything.
Well, but the thing about being like a Jedi and the way they sword fight is a lot of it is intuition. They know they can see the moves before they happen, which is why Anakin is so good at the pod races.
Mm-hmm.
But General Grievous, he's not a Jedi. So
he just swings.
Yeah, he's just swinging lasers. And so he doesn't have that intuition to be able to like, oh shit, Obi-Wan's going to dodge this way, so I should swing a lightsaber this way. And he probably doesn't have the mental capacity, especially since he's not a droid, to actually handle six limbs. That's why he's most likely using two at a time.
Two, like, distractions,
he's basically good enough not to cut himself to pieces.
Yeah. If he's a cyborg, that means he doesn't actually have an android mind, so not the computing capability of handling that many lightsabers.
He's just him. He's just a guy.
Yeah.
And learning to be kind of like a Sith fighter. Because Dooku trains him, so I'm sure you could only train him so far.
It's kind of like I'm going to go into a fencing arena, and I'm just going to put swords sticking out of my back and shit. It's not going to help me.
It could.
That could, yeah.
But going up against an experienced fencer, and I'm like, ha, ha. And he's just like, nope. As he like slices, my pants fall off.
Yeah.
I imagine that's why like Obi-Wan got through that fight so unscathed, because it's not, you know, a Jedi versus a Jedi. It's a Jedi. It's purely skill versus a guy that has a shitload of lightsabers.
Right. I could see that.
And Grievous has taken out Jedi before just because he overwhelms them with, you know, his many lightsabers and the way that he fights.
And if he's at a disadvantage, he runs.
Yep.
Oh, yeah, he easily runs.
Yeah, he never stays for a fight if he knows he's going to lose it.
That's
fine. That's a lot in Clone Wars. It's actually smart, because he's just like, fuck it, I'm saving myself.
Yeah. But I think that's why he got cocky this time, because he was like, fuck it, I got like six lightsabers, I got an army of droids around me.
Which is why Obi-Wan just popped up on there. We talked about this off the podcast, where Obi-Wan's in the rafters, and he's like, what am I going to do? And he's like, okay, I'm just going to jump in front of everybody. Yeah. And Grievous is even like, you're so bold.
Maybe he just calls that Grievous is going to do that, you know?
That's stretching it. Because all the droids are surrounded him. Grievous should have just been like, he says, kill him. But that's after, when does he say that?
He
tells those two droids to try to kill him, and they use using the spears.
Oh, the Magna Corps people.
But it's sort of like a thing of like, this guy it's coming pride. into your, calling you out. You know?
Like, hello. But I remember being like, Grievous, you've been running away already. He's really quick to, as soon as droids get there, say, kill him and I'll leave. Why? That one time he was like, fuck it, I'm going to do this. And I was like, wrong move, Grievous. If you really wanted to win, he should have done, just let the droids win or kill him.
But he tried to. He had to make a show first.
I get that, yeah.
And then he tried to run again.
Yeah.
Because then he realized, fuck, I'm not going to win this.
He was like, yeah, I can do this. I've taken out Jedi. And then he's like, no, not happening again. Yeah.
Maybe that's why, because he was like, you know what? I want to show off a little. But then he realized, oh, shit.
Show off to my sweet droid army. They respect me and stop calling me names.
Getting interpersonal.
Keep offering me cough drops. They know I can't eat them. I'll earn the respect. Helicopter lightsaber.
Knowing that he's a cyborg, I'm a little bit more okay with this character.
I like them.
But at first I thought he was just an android.
He does. I was like, come out of nowhere.
Oh, yeah.
Like, it's really just
there's no backstory.
Underdeveloped.
You know, I forgot that they killed Dooku so quickly in the beginning. Which was a great, like, I love that whole beginning battle from those little robot droids attacking Obi-Wan's ship. And then they finally get on the ship and they rescue Palpatine. And then, And Anakin's dual wielding. I like that. That's the first time they show him using two, and he just, bam, both arms gone. And I love when he has it, like, cross, and he's about to, like, chop off his head.
Yeah. Shouldn't.
He's like, I shouldn't, but then the Emperor's like, do it. And then
say that. He says,
do it.
Do it.
No, but when he says, before that, he tells him, kill him. You kill Dooku. And he's like, no, I can't. And he's like, kill him. And you can see Dooku looking at Emperor like, the fuck, man? He gives him that face of like, you just told him to kill me? Are you serious? And he's like, do it. Then he kills him. He just slices his head off. I thought
we had something.
It was a real look of like, anger / oh shit, like
confusion.
Fear.
A little bit of confusion
like,
in there.
Oh, you fuck. Like, Grievous, he should have. But then Dooku wouldn't have given him out either way, I think. But I still remember being like, oh fuck.
Dooku was naive in that part. He's a smart guy. He should have known.
But yeah, I thought he was not expecting him to. He was expecting to say Anakin's going to capture him and they'll find a way to escape later. He didn't expect Palpatine to also be like, just kill him.
Dooku's used to great effect in the Clone Wars as well.
Oh, yeah? I saw recently, maybe it's from Rebels, where he gets attacked and he can't see them. Is it in Clone Wars?
Yeah.
Where he gets Dooku gets attacked by those two Night Sisters.
Oh, yeah.
And he can't see them.
Yeah.
And he's fighting them badassly, like, and he can't see shit.
And that's Asajj Ventress. Ventress is there trying to kill him.
That's cool. I thought that was cool.
Yeah, he's great. I like Dooku.
I like Dooku. But yeah, I get that he kind of Dooku. I mean, he died so quickly, and then
yeah, I've always thought Episode 3 moved a little quickly. You know, because there was so much he had to wrap up.
I think Episode 3 was very rushed in terms of the way it was filmed.
And it's just kind of a crutch on the story that he was telling. You know, he like 3 movies wasn't enough to really expound upon every plot line that he had going on.
Yeah.
And that's why I say again, Clone Wars makes everything better.
That's probably why they made it then, because they're like, there's so much to explain.
There's so much
at least give someone like the fans something.
Yeah,
because they just cut from the start of it to the end.
Yeah,
I think there was like a gap between 1 and 2 to where there's like there's a little bit of storyline missing in those 10 years, but not a lot happens.
Nothing.
But between 2 and 3,
yeah,
there's a whole bunch of shit that goes down.
Yeah.
Yeah,
and like they try to sum it up really quick at the beginning, and I was like, whoa, yeah. Calm down.
Like Anakin had an apprentice.
Oh yeah, they don't talk about that.
What?
Of course, that's a decision that was made after the fact, after the movie. But I mean, yeah, he had an apprentice in the middle of 2 and 3.
Oh, I didn't know that.
And it's a great storyline.
They should never give that fucking kid an apprentice.
I know, right? He's not so crazy in Clone Wars, though.
No, he's not.
He's
you start to see smidgens of it, just like in Episode 2 when he murders the Tusken Raiders. There's smidgens of
parts still where he's spoiled little shit.
No, in the Clone Wars, he doesn't act. They didn't.
He's got his Episode 3 hair.
They didn't
and a scar. So
yeah, but cool. They didn't mirror Hayden's performance, of course, to popular demand.
oh my god, it's so bad.
Obi-Wan was a lot like Ewan McGregor, and Padme was a lot like. But the voice actor for Anakin did something a little different.
So, go on.
The actor that they chose for Obi-Wan was fucking great.
Ewan McGregor?
Yeah.
I like him.
He did a great job.
He was a great, like, young Ben Kenobi.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. He actually, like, even if you imagined, just besides the acting, just the physical appearance, if I imagined him aging, it would look like the original Obi-Wan.
Yeah. Well, now that's what exactly what I was going to say, that did Obi-Wan at the end of 3 and then Episode 4 Obi-Wan, that's a really big like age difference for
between 20, like 20
18 20 years tops.
Yeah, 18 20
how
years.
How many years goes by?
Cuz they never say how old Luke Skywalker is, but you can guess he's probably 18 to early 20s.
I thought Obi-Wan was in really his quick. Like 20s at Episode 1.
What?
Obi-Wan, how old was he?
How old was Obi? I don't know.
He like he the didn't way look he looks that
young, but
he
looks 30s.
He could be in his 30s, but he has that like that hairdo he has, I guess, made me think he was
younger.
It
looks younger, yeah. That's probably done on purpose.
Well, you mean in Episode 1?
Yeah. In Episode 1, he looks like really young.
Yeah, in Episode 1, he was probably in his 20s.
So that means that's in Episode 2, he was like in his 30s.
Yeah.
Then Episode 4?
Because Episode 2 was like 10 years after, roughly.
I think it's Sandface.
It is probably Sandface. Oh, that comment. That fucking comment that Anakin makes in Episode 2.
I hate sand.
And she's like, I like the beach. He's like, I fucking hate sand.
I hate sand. It's so dry and unforgiving. I don't know if that's what he said.
Oh, fucking scarred, motherfucker.
I know. That fucking bedroom talk.
Yep.
I hate sand.
And the rolling around in the grass. And they're all just playing. Yeah.
When he plays dead.
He's like, I'm just laughing the whole time. It was
a joke. That was actually pretty brutal looking, though.
When he fell off?
Yeah. He just got ran over by that thing.
Girls like when you pretend to die, right?
Yeah, totally.
Fucking Anakin.
They get that adrenaline rush.
Yeah.
That one scene where he purely just goes against all of Padme's ideologies. When she's like, you know, because it's a, he was like, I feel like the government doesn't work. And she's like, well, how should it work? He's like, people should get together and agree on things. And Padme has this look of like, that's what we have now.
But there should be one guy telling everyone what to do.
And right? She looks at him and she's like, are you serious? And he goes, no.
I don't know, maybe.
Exactly what happens. And Padme's like, oh, you're so funny.
It's like, ah, they start throwing each other in the grass.
It might as well have been like her saying, like, oh, I like, you know, a democratic system, this and this. And he might as well have just been like, I like communism. He's just like, Hitler had it, right? Yeah.
You know, I dream of a chamber in which you just put people in and then fumes come out.
Nice smelly fumes?
No.
Potpourri?
No, deadly fumes.
Oh,
much like episode one.
Oh yeah.
Damn it! I did like at the beginning of episode one. I think that was like one of my favorite parts when they're like, the droid comes up. He's to the Trade Federation guy, and he's like, "There's two Jedis here." It's like, "What? Fuck! Yeah. There's Jedis here? Oh shit!
How did we let this happen?"
He's like, "Abort! Abort!"
The Jedis are in here. Damn
and,
it!
And then Qui-Gon's like,
"How'd they get in?
I think they're aborting."
Yeah, he's just like, "I sense they know we're here."
Beep beep. There's like a flashing light in the background.
Gas comes out of the vents.
They're like, "I think they know we're here."
What is that gas?
Dioxus. Whatever they say.
We should get out of here.
The Force tells me we should go. Oh, shit. When they pass out.
I really want a line where, like, in one of the Ocean's 11 movies, there's a guy who's at, like, a psychic. And as she's talking to him, he was like, "I want to know what happens, like, with my money. I'm really worried about this one bank account." And then some mafia guys come in to take him away. And he's like, "This? You couldn't see this?" I really wanted a scene like that with the Jedi. To where, like Qui-Gon's in the room and he's like, somebody comes in and the gas starts coming out and Obi-Wan's like, "How did you not sense this?" I think that would have been a really funny thing to throw in there.
Somebody should have just said, "Oh, I didn't see that coming."
That would have been great. When the Jedi are dying.
Oh. One of them was like, "Well, I didn't see that coming."
Oh my god.
You think Who would have thought we would have died in these Star Wars? Jerome to the face.
Always with the.
They should add a title, like movie title line somewhere in all of these movies. Or someone just said Star Wars.
Did anybody really like the sound of, like, whenever Grievous had the helicopter lightsabers?
And then they were striking the ground, like,
it sounded so cool. Yeah, and that animal he had, what was that sound it made?
I don't remember.
I don't know.
It was some shit like that.
A giant lizard he could ride.
Yeah, it was like a parrot lizard.
It was like, "Yoshi."
Bonk, bonk.
I like the little lizard. I got sad when he died.
That thing could climb walls and shit.
Yeah, it was badass.
He whistled and it came. I was like, nice.
The fact that he stealthily got through like that level on that thing, though, is totally bullshit.
Yeah, right?
He's like, "I need to like slowly, stealthily make my way through this base. I'm going to ride a dinosaur."
Right. Yeah. Everyone's slowly just looking up as they hear something walk past them. Like, yeah, I heard that, right?
Look, I imagine like there's a part, like a hallway, and like the stormtroopers have their back to it, and they hear right back. Did you hear something?
That reminds me of a Robot Chicken sketch where they're at it's the Mandarin headquarters, and there's just two guys guarding the headquarters, and all of a sudden they just hear like metal hitting metal, and they're like, "What is that?" And the other guy's, "It's Iron Man. He's coming on here," because he's all heavy suit. He's making a shitload of noise as he's trying to hide. And they're like, and they hear it stop, and they're like, "Oh, well, I guess he went away." And they start hearing from above, and they're like, "Oh, god damn it, he's in the vents." He just hear as he's climbing through the vents in his heavy ass suit.
It's funny.
It's fucking great.
Ultimate power.
Unlimited.
Unlimited power, that's right.
The way that Darth Sidious got Anakin to go on his side, part of me was like, it stretched a lot. It went from being Anakin to being a little suspicious to, you know what, fuck all the Jedi.
Yeah, but like, I laughed because he tells him, he sits him down and he's like,
"Oh boy,
he can sense what his fear is, you know?
Yeah.
He's a Sith Lord, so he can tell that he doesn't want Padme to die and all this stuff. So he plays off that a lot. But he tells them, you know, there used to be this guy. His name was Darth Plagueis, and he figured out how to fight death. And, he could save people from dying. And he's like, he could really save people from dying? He's like, yes, he knew how to do it. And then he was killed. And they're like, whoa. And then later on, after he, changes them, he's like, don't worry, Anakin. After they kill Mace, he's like, I'm sure we can figure that out.
And yeah.
Anakin should have been like, you said you could do that. You said you knew how to do it. What do you mean?
You told me you thought you went for things. You know.
I just killed Mace. Yeah. What the fuck, man? Instead, he was just like, I'll give you everything. I'll do whatever you want, my master.
Even the part where he kills Mace seemed like a bit of a stretch to me. To be like, for him to be going. I mean, I know he wanted to save Padme, but to go as far as to kill Mace.
He was a little too desperate.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know. It just jumped really quick.
I actually liked the way the Emperor and Mace were fighting. When he does the lightning, it's reflecting back on him. It's hitting him.
Yeah.
And he's basically like, what's the word? Like crying, like save me, and just being really weak. I'm too weak, and playing it up so much.
Yeah.
I was like, that's totally like in his nature. It's very like manipulative. Mm-hmm. He's getting Anakin, please help me. You know, he's not supposed to kill me. Mace is the one turning type thing. And then as soon as he gets the upper hand, he's like, ah! I love that dude. He's like cackling and doing crazy smiling the whole time.
You know, he was pretty freaky.
He was so crazy
in the part where they confronted him.
Yeah,
Mace and the three other Jedi, and he just wiped the floor with the other guys.
Oh man,
who were unprepared completely.
No. Yeah, like what the fuck? They didn't even do anything. They didn't even raise a single lightsaber.
One of them got taken out just immediately.
Yes,
in my head, I was like, "Come on, Mace, you brought these guys." You're going to go fight
the Sith Lord in the war.
Mace didn't seem like rushed at all. Like when he told him like Palpatine's the Sith Lord, he just said, okay, I guess we'll go after him.
Yeah, he should have waited until be like, hey Yoda, I need to tell you something. We should probably get all the Jedi together.
It should have been a big deal.
Yeah. They should have gotten everybody together. They should have I guess the way Anakin said it.
They should have planned something.
Like went through the proper
things. See, that was a bad call that Mace made because he went there to kill him.
Basically, you know. Yeah. Well, he kept saying, I'm going to arrest you, but after he got attacked twice.
He had no intention to.
He was like, he's too much of a threat. I have to kill him.
Yeah.
But, yeah, what was it? He was like, I guess I'll take these guys since they're already standing here. Come with me.
No,
I
want to
say that was very much more, it wasn't so much a Jedi move as it was a Samuel L. Jackson move.
He's like, I can do this, motherfucker.
This motherfucker's too dangerous.
Say Sith again. I dare you. Did you like the explanation of why he's so like, the Emperor's so like, face is all messed up? Because he got Sith lightning to the face?
No.
I was okay with it, I guess.
But his face changed so dramatically.
Yeah.
Like, even Mace Windu when he's getting attacked, or anybody else.
It also seemed like more of a revealing.
Yeah, like maybe he had makeup on and lightning melted it.
I was going to bring the theory that I remember reading that the theory was that he's always looked like that and he uses Sith magic to hide his appearance.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
And he couldn't, like after that, there was no need to also like try to do it again.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And the lightning kind of just, yeah, it took it away.
Mm. That makes more sense to me.
I actually like that theory a lot, that he's just creepy.
Yes.
I don't like the idea that it's the lightning that did that to him.
Yeah, because it doesn't disfigure or hurt anyone else.
No, yeah, you're right. I think that was
Luke got fucking smashed.
Oh yeah,
and he was fine.
He was getting lightning for a long time. Everyone got lightning. You get some lightning, and you get some lightning.
Yeah, but Luke just straight got blasted for like 5 minutes straight.
Yeah, mm-hmm. While Darth Vader just sat there like,
You know, they're releasing
disfigure his face.
You know, they're releasing a Darth Vader action figure where the helmet is electrified.
Really?
Yeah, and it's showing like the skull, what it looked like.
Oh, that's cool. I like that.
Ooh.
Yeah, because when he's getting shocked, you can see his like skeleton mm-hmm. and stuff. That's cool. I like how Mace just gets flown out the window.
Yeah,
and just shoot him out the window.
Very open-ended.
Yeah, I was thinking, well, what if he didn't die? But I guess you gotta assume he died. His arm's chopped off. Not that that matters.
Maybe he's always like unconscious from the electrical attacks.
If he
fell,
if he is so alive. Far. he wouldn't be brought back in the movies. He might be brought back in Rebels.
Maybe, yeah. But he'd have to die somewhere.
Because that's what happened with Maul. He didn't come back in the movies. He came back in the show.
Yeah. Cartoon. Just shot him out the window. He's like, ah!
What I wanted more of was Django.
They should They should have shown him getting hit by a speeder car going by. anyway. Yeah.
Like, as he gets hit, it's like,
like Titanic style. And the dude's falling off the ship and he hits the propeller.
Yeah.
Just midway like down, just bam.
That would have been so good. Oh, man. Like, well, that solves that.
That would have broken.
He could
the
still
moment.
Live. He could still. Oh, no. No,
no, he's dying. Now.
He hit that car. And that second car.
I really wanted more Django.
Django was cool, though.
Like, because
I'm glad we saw the ship, though. Like,
yeah.
The sun and slave.
I really, really enjoyed the desperate fight. Right outside of the clone place.
Oh, in the rain.
Oh, in the rain?
Yeah, in the rain where it's like...
That was a good fight.
Straight desperation.
Mm-hmm.
Like every move that he made was like, fuck, 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 everything's going wrong. I just have to get back to the ship and take off.
Yeah.
When he's like, I cannot handle Jedi right now.
Yeah.
But then that's what got me when he died is because he was like, you know what? I had a really hard time with that one Jedi. I was going to jump in this arena of 50
I
of
should
them.
Be able to take out another Jedi.
Or 20.
Yeah, and then he's shooting at Mace... And Mace is getting closer, blocking shots. He's like, oh, shit, oh, shit. I'll just keep shooting. Nope. And then head off.
Well, he doesn't have a jetpack at that point.
Yeah, because jetpack
Oh, yeah, he didn't have a jetpack.
After,
could have tried the flamethrower.
He could have tried the flamethrower.
Just constantly fucked the fits
He should have just moved. He wasn't even running.
No, he's right, though.
What?
Jetpacks just constantly fucked the fits
over. Every single Fett dies from a jetpack malfunction.
It did work for that one time so he could get away after he killed the assassin.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But that was like, didn't have to fly away. He was so far away when he shot that girl that he could have just stayed there and hidden. Mm-hmm. Instead, he's like, I better leave. And they're like, what was that? Oh, look at that guy flying on a jetpack. It must be him. It was so obvious.
Yeah.
Well, they are Jedi. He was probably just getting the fuck out of town.
Let me track down the one person in the entire galaxy that owns a jetpack.
Yep.
That's true. There's not like a lot of jetpacks.
There are no jetpacks.
It's literally
There's
just
one.
I did like you could see, he shot the missile from
I think, I think jetpacks are a Mandalorian thing.
Are they?
Because we see Mandalorians at some point, and they all have jetpacks.
Mm.
And Mandalorians, they're more like of a group of people, right? They're not.
Yeah.
They're not a species. Right?
Oh
no, they're not a species.
Right? Because I heard in another podcast they were talking about that, and somebody Googled it.
They're a group of people on a planet called Mandalore.
Okay.
Yeah.
And they're all just bounty hunters.
Half of the planet is.
Half of the planet.
Well, half of the planet are like. I don't know how to explain it. Half of the planet are a bunch of Jango Fett.
And Jango Fett is just a terrible bounty hunter that decides, you know what, let me just sell my DNA.
Basically.
For money.
Did anyone laugh when his Jango Fett and his son and Boba are flying and he's doing those weird little bombs that sound like guitars? Like,
Oh, yeah. I kind of like that.
But then he's like, the Boba's like, get him, Dad!
Yeah, that was pretty funny.
I was like, God damn it, Boba, shut the fuck up.
Yeah, Django wasn't really the fuck up. He just got caught in a weird situation.
Yeah, yeah. Django was actually pretty badass.
Yeah, that's why I wanted more of him, because he was what I wanted Boba to be.
I think that was the point. He showed what Boba Fett was supposed to be.
Yeah.
So now you can assume that he's, since they're clones, it's the same. That's how
I think it's, Boba Fett would be. I think it's a lot of, like, Boba wants to be Jango, but Jango died, so he never trained Boba. So
exactly.
Boba just kind of like, I think this is what my dad did. And he was a dumbass about it because he didn't know what he was doing. He was just all like, jetpack and laser. And
that's why he fell in the pit, because he doesn't know how to work the fucking jetpack.
That's the whole generation of people not being trained. Luke not trained. Boba not trained.
Yeah. That's funny.
That's a good point.
Get him, dude.
That's why he flew into the side of the ship.
Yeah.
Look at
But Django, he's very cool. He was very, like, intimidating when Obi-Wan comes to talk to him.
Yeah.
He's very, like...
stare down?
Yeah.
He's like, have you been there? He's like, maybe.
That was
super
tense.
Was he super short? I think he was super short. Or at least Obi-Wan was tall.
He didn't look too much shorter.
About the same height?
Really? Oh, okay. I just remember it being a downward angle.
Yeah, it was there was a lot
was
of like
just,
tension there.
Yeah, the angle.
And the little alien in the background was just like, everything's fine.
I think they always had to have like the downward angle so that you could see Boba in the background, I think.
Oh, yeah.
It wasn't
Good
so
point.
Much of like a
Good
talking.
Point.
Yeah.
Because otherwise you would just see like the tip of Boba's head like in the screen.
You just see little Eric yelling, get him!
Little fist comes up.
Get him, Dan.
Yeah, that's Boba's new catchphrase. To us.
I want to make a t-shirt that just has like Boba Fett's mask on it. Instead of anything cool at the bottom, it just says, get him, Dad!
Get him, Dad!
Oh, man.
Jango Fett's cool. They should have kept him.
Do they have like a stereotypical uniform that they use?
Who?
Fett's?
It looked like it was probably the same armor.
Yeah, I think Boba just took Jango's armor.
He took his head out of the armor.
Yeah, he did.
He rinsed it out.
Ooh.
And then was like, I'm going to wear this in 20
years. He
didn't
have to rinse anything out. It was a cauterized neck.
He had to take the head out. He had to just
pop it out.
He had to rinse out for sweat, dead skin cells.
Or he didn't.
He Q-boned it.
He Q-boned it.
Good reference, my friend.
Yeah. He's like, oh, put the helmet on.
Oh, my God. That was too good.
It's kind of gross.
I want to make a Pokedex entry for that. And just keep Cubone's entry, but replace Cubone with Boba.
Bobone.
Oh,
how did Boba figure out of there? I realize they just left him there. Everyone's like, the battle's over, and he's just holding this dad's head like,
Just I'm an orphan now.
You're my ride.
Well, the ship must be there. I'm sure he knows how to fly.
I'm sure
he showed that he knew how to fly because he was getting it ready for his dad.
Yeah. I bet he went to go live back on.
We also see him in Clone Wars.
Boba?
As a kid, yeah.
Oh. Is he like, get him, Stormtrooper, who looks like my dad?
Oh.
Would that be weird, right?
How much would that fuck with you?
Get him 500,000 dads.
I got all the dads.
He basically had to sit there and watch an army of dads fight his dad.
Oh, yeah.
And then, like, later on, he meets, like, a stormtrooper, and he's like, Dad?
I thought you were
they
dead.
Didn't fight Jango, because he was dead by the time the clones got there.
Like, it was still, like...
Yeah.
But, yeah, he comes to, like, the mess hall, and they're all just there. He's like, what the...
Dad? Yeah.
Does Boba Fett know he's a clone?
I don't know. They didn't address that.
Because otherwise he wouldn't call him Dad.
Yeah. But also, is it weird that Jango Fett's like, I just want to I want to raise myself.
No, maybe he just wants a kid.
That's kind of weird. It's still you.
Yeah.
Like, I want a kid, so I just have a clone of myself.
Well, I can see
all the clones were very different.
Well, no, they said Boba Fett, they were just going to leave him alone. They didn't do anything different to him. But I was just thinking, like, that's kind of an odd choice. I assume he's just going to raise him to be a bounty hunter, too.
Did Boba have the growth acceleration, too?
No. That's why he was still, like, young and all the other ones were fully grown, because they all got cloned at the same time.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, they said they do them in waves.
But they specifically said that...
The first wave was getting ready for battle.
Well, yeah, but for Jango, despite getting paid... Well, with also getting paid, he requested... to live there and a clone of his own that was completely unaltered.
Mm.
So it's just, I guess, assume that that's why he's little still.
When they said unaltered, they meant more so the personality wise because they're all trained to be obedient.
Yeah.
Their chemical balance in their brain is altered specifically so that they're obedient and they don't talk back. That's what they were saying that Boba didn't have.
That's true. He does have more free will.
Yeah.
He does have more free will, but I think the aging thing was also part of like the unaltered was
it? I put it with that because was part of their clone growth, too. They had to get him up to speed.
That obedience factor is kind of tested in Clone Wars.
Yeah.
Yeah. We kind of see them
they're just like running off to their death. They're going to just run off to their death. They're like, fuck it.
No, I'm saying that's tested a bit by the clones. You know, they kind of... bring it up how robotic they all are and question orders.
They mention that?
They start questioning
in the Clone
orders.
Wars.
Yeah, in the Clone Wars.
I thought for some reason, I thought you meant the episode 2.
Mm-hmm. They start questioning stuff. And
that's interesting. Because I was always wondering that they can't, like, especially in the last three movies, and especially with The Force Awakens, because you find out that Finn is a stormtrooper, they clearly aren't still cloning stormtroopers at that point.
That stopped after prequels.
Yeah, at that point they were like, we've already taken over the universe. We can now like take you or the galaxy. We'll just use like our people from the planets.
Yeah,
and use them to get into the Empire.
Mm-hmm.
But
what was up with the fact that the guy who commissioned the clone army was like dead 10 years ago. Cypher Diaz. I felt like that was convenient.
Did somebody just use his name?
I figured it had to have been, like he died and they used his name to just still do this. Maybe Palpatine or Dooku from back then?
Maybe.
Yeah, because Palpatine definitely was in charge of it.
Yeah.
And
he would have known of their...
He was...
It's just that it was such a secret thing, and the fact that they took off the planet from the directory, too.
I figured Dooku did that, because Dooku, like they were saying that he was a Jedi, so he would still have access to... Because they said only a Jedi can do this.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, I don't think Sidious would have been able to go in and access the records. It would have had to have been Dooku.
Yeah, I agree with that. It's just so convenient. It kind of seemed a little weird.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, I think he definitely went in there and used a fake name just so that, you know, it couldn't be traced back to him.
Yeah.
And that alien race doesn't care because they addressed that earlier. It's whatever's in your pocketbook.
Mm-hmm.
You know, your business. That's all they care about.
Get us paid.
So they're like, oh, that's the name you're going to give us? All right.
Like, sure.
They were so nice, too.
Yeah, they were.
They were the nicest aliens in there.
Because they're business. They're just like, we're going to be cordial. Partners.
Yeah.
And please give us money. You're giving us money?
You've given us the money. Here's your army.
I like how, like, the interview part where they're like, I assume you're here to see the clones. The clones? Oh, you don't know.
Yeah. They should have been like, oh, nothing?
They don't. I guess they don't piece it together. They're like, I don't think this guy bought clones.
No, yeah, right? They don't. They're just like, oh, you know, the clones Cypher Diaz made.
He's like, Cypher Diaz hasn't been here for ages. And they're like, oh, but you still going to pay us for them, right?
But do you still want them? Because they're done. They're eating lunch right now.
We're
in the mess
paying
hall.
To feed them. Can you get them away from us now?
Yeah, like I understand that
expensive.
Obi-Wan kind of plays along.
Yeah, but he's not good at playing along.
Yeah, it was kind of really obvious. And you'd think that they would have been like, I don't think he ordered them.
Let's not talk to you anymore.
Unless he mind tricked them?
They didn't seem that in tune with reality, though.
No.
And also, too, the fact that someone was like, we want these clones made, and then they have no, like, communication to anyone while they're making these clones for the next 10 years. And then a Jedi comes, and they're like, you must be the guy.
He's all like, the guy. And they're like, yes, the guy. He's like, yes.
Yeah, I am the guy. I'm the guy. I'm here for guy stuff.
Okay.
I like those long necks.
Tell me.
The guy?
What's the job of the guy?
That just seemed a bit too convenient to me.
Yeah, it really was. Anywho, but I think we pretty much went over every single thing.
Yeah, I don't have much.
We broke it down almost completely.
There was a great shot of Uncle Owen and Aunt Beru.
Yeah, Beru.
Beru holding little Luke baby at the end, looking at the sunset the way Luke was.
That was nice. Well, yeah, she gets the baby first and she walks up to Owen.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was nice. I liked when they were just like in episode 2 when he goes back and he's like, stop throwing candy at me.
Episode 2.
Oh, where Anakin goes back and he's like, who are you? And he's like, oh, you must be my stepbrother. I'm Owen. This is my girlfriend, Beru.
I had a problem with that. I think I talked to you about it. Was that the continuity issues?
Yeah.
Was in episode 4 is where Uncle Owen and all of them are. And I guess whenever they start episode 1, it's just Anakin and his mom. And then I guess whenever they started, at the end of that movie, George Lucas was like, oh shit, I forgot Anakin's supposed to have a brother.
Yeah.
That's supposed to be Uncle Owen. He's like, fuck, how am I going to write that in there? Oh, I'm just going to sell his mom later, and then she would remarry somebody, and this and that. And I was just like, that just seems a lot of like, by the way, Annie, when you were gone, this happened. Because of plot holes.
Mm.
Basically, because there's no time. I forgot to throw that in there.
Yeah. And it couldn't be his directly related brother, so he was like, oh, I'm your stepbrother.
Is he, that's what I didn't catch, but then I think I realized it just now. He's the dad's son, right?
Yeah.
He's not like, they had a, her and, him and Shmi had a no, kid, no. And that's Owen?
Yeah, he's a stepbrother.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. I thought about that, I was like, oh, they had a whole nother family after he, like, Anakin left. Then I was like, no, because he's too old. But I guess, maybe. because he looks kind of young. And then I was like, this guy bought a slave and he fell in love with her. I guess that's interesting. And then they had a family. What if that was a slave baby first and then he decided to make her free? I don't know. Those were my thoughts.
I didn't like it.
That was a lot of weird thoughts.
I like it. It was just a very... My mind
jumped way too much in that little bit.
It just seemed like very much a, shit, I forgot to write this in. How can I write it in?
Same with the showing Beru there. She didn't need to be there. Oh, this is my girlfriend, Beru.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
It's a little hand-holding for the kids.
Oh, yeah. What the fuck were the sand people doing with his mom?
I don't know.
Sex slave?
Dude, I said that yesterday. I said she was a sex slave.
You think so?
I kind of think
what
so.
What else?
Fuck, I don't know.
I don't mean to press about it. I'm just saying that doesn't really... Tusken Raiders are animals.
It makes sense that that's why they would keep her around for so long.
Yeah, because they said it'd been a month since she was abducted.
And,
yeah.
In a way, he was in the right to slaughter them.
Oh, yeah. If that was the case.
I mean, maybe not the kids and women, but...
Fuck it. He was good to kill most of them. Because that was pretty fucked up.
I like how Juan basically just said, nah, infanticide? Go ahead.
That's a word?
Infanticide?
Well, yeah.
That was the one part where I was like, when he killed the kids, I was like...
They're going to die on their own.
They're not going to grow up to be big Tusken Raiders.
I understood him like killing the rest of the Tusken Raiders, but when they showed like the little kids, I was like, shit. Don't kill the kids, Annie.
Did they show the kids? I didn't even remember seeing the little Tusken Raider babies.
Did they not show them?
I don't think so. I think he just says that he kills the kids.
Yeah, he says it.
He did them.
I imagined it, maybe.
The children. Yeah.
I slaughtered them like animals.
It's not just the men. The women and children, too.
The women and the children.
Even at that point, Padme should have just been like, whoa.
Yeah, right? She'd be like, whoa.
Well, I don't
What's
know.
This red flag doing here?
I don't know, man. She probably tried to, you know,
I get it. Sympathize. She was grieving. He's a person that kills people for the Republic. Bad people, but... That's a little much. I get that she probably was just
they're
going to
grow up to become horrible Tusken Raiders.
So. Still, that's true. Still, that's like mini genocide.
It's not like they were going to turn their life around.
That's like saying, like, I'm gonna marry this one Nazi work like soldier or whatever. It doesn't matter that he killed a small Jewish village.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Granted, the small Jewish village did rape his mother, but...
Was the mom calling out to him? While she was captured, to get those premonitions he was having? Because it seems like she just kind of like... I figured if she was calling out to him, not knowing that she's calling out to him, but
you mean by the time like he got in there?
Yeah, because...
I thought she was unconscious.
It had been a month, and I was like, why is it... It's too convenient that he finds her, and she dies like right there.
Well, because he also senses when Padme's going to die.
Which is why I was thinking that she had already been captured, and he could feel, but he didn't know that's what... That's what, like, he's feeling, that she's captured already.
He could just sense that the trouble
he
was coming.
He sensed that trouble was coming, but maybe it was, and maybe her cries were somehow connected to him, since he's supposed to be super force sensitive. And she was basically, for whatever reason, holding out as long as she could, because she's still thinking of Anakin. And then when he finally does come and gets her, she's like, I can basically die now. I wanted to see you. That was, like, her last wish. And then she sees him, and he dies. She dies.
Yeah, I had no problem with her death at all. I had a problem with Padme's death.
Yes, they're like, she seems to be fine. We don't know what's going wrong.
Maybe because at that point they were like, we still don't have a trigger for him to completely go to the dark side.
So even then, he said, the Emperor tells him, well, you killed her. He was like, no, she was still alive. He's like, no, you killed her.
No.
But I think, like, for
she died from a broken heart is bullcrap.
But the story for him to, like, go to the dark side, Padme needed to be in trouble. It needed to be something. Because of the whole storyline, I guess, revolves around the fact that because he did break the Jedi Code by having a relationship, that's kind of what led to him going to the dark side. Because his feelings were all over the place.
Yeah. I think he should have killed her. Like, only in the sense that when he was choking her, it should have turned out that she died because of that. He inadvertently killed her, and that's why he was seeing He saw that she was going to die, but he didn't know how. And he changed the future by it being him.
Well, that's what I thought happened when the doctors were like, she seems good medically. We don't know what's happening. And then they're like,
they should have
just
said
lost
that.
The will to live.
Yeah.
Like, no. That's not how that works.
They should have said she was choked too long. She's suffering.
Yeah.
We need to get the babies out. And let's do what we can.
When people say we can
change that for ourselves. Yeah. Let's just think that like that.
Like she was perfectly fine. She just lost the will.
Lethal Weapon 5.
Well, because when people say they've lost the will to live, that's more like their body should be recovering, but it's not.
Yeah.
But in this case, they're like, nope, she's in perfect health.
She's already fine.
She just doesn't want to die, or she just doesn't want to live.
She doesn't want to live. That's selfish of her. She's got twins.
Two kids.
Yeah.
Two kids.
Fuck.
Padme, you bitch.
Fuck that. Yeah, right. Man. And then Darth Vader should have never said no. He should have just crushed the whole building.
No,
as he was doing that, he saw the Emperor was smiling.
Yeah, 90% of that scene was extremely epic.
Yeah. He's doing it, and the Emperor's in the background. You see a little smile just kind of.
I do like that physically he didn't move around a lot because he's in a brand new body, so he's like.
He stumbles when he takes like a first couple steps. They're kind of like.
Yeah.
Big, like, awkward steps. But he rips himself out of the thing.
Yeah, I was like, oh, shit.
Yeah.
But then as soon as he goes, no! I was sitting there going, no.
Yeah. No, please. Please, no.
No, Vader.
I feel like, what's his name? Leia's step-parents. Organa.
Senator Organa.
Yeah. I wonder why he didn't just take both. I get
well,
that
they said they had to separate them, didn't they?
Oh, yeah, you're right, that they should separate
them. To keep
them
safe. And they even mentioned that in episode 6.
That's true.
No, that's exactly what we're referencing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But then Obi-Wan was like, bring him to Tatooine, where he was born.
I like how one of them was like, let's raise this one in a really nice, like, up class with a
fancy,
really rich politician. Throw this kid to the desert with the ex-slaves.
Yes.
He did not just do that.
Play it again.
Play it to the mic.
3, 2.
You killed him.
No!
That's awesome.
I wonder how James Earl Jones felt having to do that.
Is that him?
Oh, yeah, of course.
I could tell that was his voice, but I didn't know that was him going, no.
It did
I'm sure he looked at it and he's like, he just saw all the O's on there. He's like, what? Like, what?
When he first read it, he saw, like, no. And they're like, no, you gotta make it more epic than that. He's like,
James, you gotta put a faster, more intense.
No.
Do I have to do this?
No. No! I just imagine him doing it over and over again. No?
No.
Maybe they just auto-tuned it to make that.
No! No.
I need you to sound distressed.
No.
They were like, fuck it. Whatever.
This movie sucks. Just put it
in. I
feel
like there's a lot of.
We've been doing this for 3 hours.
I feel like there was a lot of that going on.
Of what? This movie sucks? Just put it in there?
No, just like good enough.
Oh, yeah. I read that they had to do when Anakin's dying, they had to go back and refilm the part where Obi-Wan picks up the lightsaber.
Because
George Lucas forgot to put that in there. And someone was like, he needs to have that so that he can give it to Luke. And he's like, oh yeah, okay. Just y'all film it.
It's pretty seamless.
Yeah.
I'll give him that.
It's because it's really just that clip. Is just the arm picking up the lightsaber and walking away.
It's kind of easy to like make it seamless when it's all CGI.
It's probably not even on the same set.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They just set up a little corner or something, like in a closet, and they're like, all right, this is what it looked like.
That's true.
Yeah.
They've like, already broken down the sets. It's months later. Like,
don't even bring Obi-Wan back. We still have the costume, right? Put it on the intern.
Just super glue his face to Ewan McGregor's face to the intern.
No, just a beard. Just put the facial hair on him.
It actually shows his back to the camera, doesn't it? So
I think so.
We don't even see his face.
Yeah.
That might not be him.
It might not be.
I think that's what the big problem I had was 3. Because like, remember I was saying like the order of my favorites?
Yeah.
Because we were saying yours
his
is
order of Tom. His order of favorites is 1, 2, 3.
Mm-mm.
What? Like overall? Or
no,
just
no, no,
no,
no.
From the prequels.
Prequels.
1, 2, 3.
1, 2, 3.
Like just go in order.
Like the best was 1.
And then is it 4, 5, 6 or 4, 6, 5?
Because I liked 1 because it was a really good intro to it, and I was like, you know what, these prequels might be good.
Mm-hmm.
And then 2 came, and I was like, the love thing kind of really sucked, but the action scenes were amazing. And then at three, there was just so many things where I was like, it feels like forced. Mm-hmm. Like they had a schedule. They're like, no, we got to put this movie out because the merchandise people want to sell all these toys. Yeah. And we just got to film this really quick. Oh, this doesn't make sense? Fuck it. Throw it in there. And I guess a lot of that was just very jarring as I was watching it. So it didn't, like, sit as well. Mm-hmm. And then there maybe it's also the emotional part of, like, no, I don't like this. When all the fucking Jedi died.
Ah, yeah. That was the coolest part, though.
Yeah, it was.
Yeah.
So I go six. No, what is it? Three.
You said 3-1-2.
3-1-2. That's me as well.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think so as well.
3-1-2?
Yeah.
Only because Anakin and Kid Anakin and Jar Jar ruined the first one for me now.
I like Jar Jar.
I hate Jar Jar.
I think if I ignore Jar Jar. I think if you ignore Jar Jar, that's why it's my favorite. If you can ignore Jar Jar.
What about Kid Anakin?
And Kid Anakin didn't bother me that bad.
I like seeing Little Greedo.
Did you see Little Greedo?
You didn't see Little Greedo? Yeah. He's one of his little friends.
What? Yeah.
That's Little Greedo.
That's Little Greedo.
Or at least the speech.
Where did that kid go wrong?
There's a deleted scene where after the race, Greedo and Anakin are like arguing and they're kind of like fighting, and Qui-Gon comes and like breaks them up and he's like, hey, what are you doing? What's wrong? And Anakin's like, this guy says I cheated in the race. And Greedo, he turns to Greedo and he's like, do you think he cheated? And Greedo's like, yeah, you fucking cheated. And Anakin's like, and then he turns to Anakin's like, well, did you cheat? And Anakin's like, no. And he's like, well, who cares? Let's go. And he splits them up. He's like, come on. And he takes Anakin and they leave. But then someone in the background is like, be careful, Greedo. You'll get into trouble one day. I was like, oh, God damn it.
No. See, those are the kind of references I didn't like.
Watch out, Greedo. You'll be sure to get into trouble one day. It's like,
I didn't even catch that was Greedo.
Don't go into that cantina, Greedo. Yeah. In 20 years. 30 years.
I'll start working for the mob.
So bad.
Jabba the Hutt was... The CGI one is not nearly as disturbing as the puppet one.
No, the CGI one is terrible. It's awful.
It's the best.
Yeah.
Oh, that tongue. You know there's like four people in that puppet?
Okay. We got it. what did y'all think of the announcers?
Those two-headed guys?
I didn't like them.
They were okay.
I thought they were funny.
They made me laugh.
I liked them, yeah.
They made me laugh.
I thought the one guy was like way too... Like you were saying, what's the fucking 50s diner doing here?
Yeah.
What is the fucking like announcer from the dog track doing here? Oh, we're running out of space.
Oh, no.
Oh, boy.
Now this is pod racing.
We may have to cut it short. I don't know what's wrong. I think it's almost out of space.
What do you mean space?
Like recording space.
Spice. All right, we're wasting time doing this. So if we want to wrap it up now.
Oh, wait. I also hated how Anakin blew up the Trade Federation ship
on accident.
Yeah, okay, that was bullshit.
What is this button?
Okay.
That was pretty fun to have him up there, though.
No.
Stupid.
No, that part was bad.
He did not need to be there.
I think that's just brought down here.
He needed to do something.
No, it was dumb.
He had R2 with him. R2 had everything under control.
R2 was a badass. I'm glad they showed off how
R2 was the true hero of episode 1.
Oh my god, yeah, he saved everyone when they were escaping Naboo.
Yes.
So yeah.
R2.
Nobody gives a shit about
R2. Actually,
he
saves everyone all the time. I don't know why.
He's the true hero of Star Wars.
I like how was it in 3 where he's with they're like, maybe R2 will come save us. And then R2 comes out, and he's being surrounded by battle droids. And he shocks one of the droids. And the droid gets pissed off and kicks him and knocks him over. Look at little R2 just fighting his ass off.
They give the droids a little personality in the third one.
Yeah.
Which was fun.
Good stuff.
Okay, there's one thing that really pissed me off. The midichlorian thing.
Boo.
I was like, what the fuck is this?
It wasn't needed.
It's weird because it's not even really that original because they basically took the word mitochondria and changed it to midichlorian. Because like mitochondria are those things in your body that they're their own like technique. They have their own genetic cells and they're the ones that create energy in your body. So basically George Lucas was like, I'll just change this word around and instead of them giving you energy, they give you magic.
The force. I'm not creative.
I don't think midichlorians gave the person like force sensitivity.
But it allowed them to. It was what allowed them to feel the Force.
It was like,
yeah, because they're like supposed to be weird sentient cells.
Well, they didn't necessarily say that it had anything to.
We're back.
Sweet.
We don't know where we left off.
It cut off right where Stryker was like saying that they didn't actually say that the midichlorian thing.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, okay.
Okay. So.
But yeah, I didn't like that.
The thing was, they didn't need it. They only talked about it there, and never again was it brought up.
It's just weird that they like you can genetically test if someone can be a Jedi.
Yeah,
I was like,
is that how they find them as kids?
I think you can genetically test if someone is sensitive to the Force.
I guess that makes sense.
I think it's a little weird. It's more of a contingency because he's like, I feel this, but nobody's gonna believe me.
Yeah, he couldn't prove it.
I need this additional proof to take to the council so they can see.
Yeah, and the council at that were just like, okay, we still don't agree with you about this.
Yeah,
you
know? They're like, well, maybe we see what you're talking about, but
he is strong.
Some shit's gonna go down, and you shouldn't do this.
Yeah, I still don't. It wasn't needed.
And then he was like, but the numbers.
I thought that's how they always pick people. Like, you could just sense that they're force sensitive in some way.
Yeah. That makes more sense to me than be like, oh, his blood is, but he's type O negative blood type or something like that.
He even tells Shmi, you know, his mom, that he was like, there's something different about him, right? And everyone seems to have noticed these things, but no one knows why. And you come across Qui-Gon, who's like, well, this is why, because he's strong in the Force.
Maybe Qui-Gon also sensed his unstableness and knew that Yoda wasn't going to go for it. So he was like, look how strong he is.
Like, we need to do something about this, or else he's going to end up being, like,
yeah, we need
he
could
turn out bad later on. And be a
somebody's going to train him. It needs to be one of us.
Yeah.
Kind
of
thing.
Needed to be him.
And it did it anyway.
Yeah.
Someone's got to be us, but not me, though.
I did kind of like how they at the end of episode 3 where they're like, by the way, I have one training for you, Obi-Wan, to go and learn how to basically sense people when they come back.
They threw it in the right at the end. He was like, oh, Qui-Gon Jinn, your old master knows how to contact me from the grave. He's like, Qui-Gon? Yes. And now you have to train to do it.
You know what? I changed my mind. I don't like that part.
They needed it because they have never explained Force Ghosts. You needed something.
But it was perfectly cool enough to have it be something that just happens in the later movies. Yeah. It doesn't have to happen in the early movies.
I'm with you.
I feel like, I think when I watched it like a couple of hours ago, it was a like cool reference. But like the more I thought about it, I was like,
Yoda basically saying, Qui-Gon figured this out after he died. And taught Yoda how to do it. And Yoda
was still behind that little door as a ghost, just meditating. Oh, I died.
Oh yeah, I died. Damn it.
Let me just figure this.
See, because that's a little weird. Oh, you figured it out after you're dead. Everyone else figures it out before they die, and they do that.
Mm.
So that's odd.
Mm.
I don't like it. You're right, Kramer. It's dumb. It's dumb.
Yeah.
Yeah, because didn't Obi-Wan do that? Like he died on purpose so that he could do that.
Yeah, he did it himself. Same with Yoda, assumingly. He dies and he fades away.
But
they knew how to do it. But Qui-Gon's the only person who figured out how to do it while he was dead. So that assumes that he died, figured out how to like put his spirit back together with the Force, learn this move, and then come to Yoda and teach him how to do it. That's too much.
Yeah.
That's too much. If you're dead, you're dead. Like, I don't know.
But and then the fact that they have Anakin come back...
And he wasn't taught that.
Yeah.
He just does it. He just comes back at the end. I read something that in one of these books, which is not canon anymore, that Qui-Gon Jinn apparently learned back in like thousands of years ago with all the Jedi, Force Ghosts was like a thing everyone knew how to do. Mm-hmm. And over time, people forgot how to do it. And then Qui-Gon Jinn comes in contact with these people who are... like force sensitive people. They're like shamans, but they're not Jedi, they're not anything. They know they're force sensitive.
Mm-hmm.
And they teach him how to do the Force Ghost thing. And in turn he teaches it back. But that's not canon anymore, so it doesn't matter. And it's not explained in the movies. But that was like how someone worked out that to make sense. That he did learn it before he died. He just didn't tell anyone.
I feel like Lucas goes off.
Tons of retconning.
He seems like really ADD, and he's like, I'm going to write this, and he goes off like on tangents, and he doesn't care if the tangents make sense.
No, just watch the other movies and like put stuff together, and I don't know. Someone should have just been with him to be like, that doesn't make sense.
Which is why the original three movies were so good, because like he had somebody else writing with him, right?
Yeah.
They could have been like
Kasdan wrote with him.
It was probably Kasdan was like
5 and 6. And George didn't even direct 5 and 6.
And those guys could have been like the ones that were like, you can't do this because in episode 4 this happened.
All they needed was some like, since it had been like 20 fact plus checkers. Years. Fact yeah, checkers. Just get nerds. There was already Star Wars nerds. Just get a bunch of Star Wars nerds and
the same like, ones that tore the movies apart when they came out.
Exactly. And be like, look, guys, here's what we got. We need input. Fact check stuff for us. We need another eye to see it. And yeah. Then they would have been like, well, none of this makes sense.
I think
and that's it.
The
simple.
The flaw in that is if you get a bunch of purists together to, you know, fact check and alter all these storylines, it's going to turn into like a big geek fest rather than, you know, a sales giant.
Like fan wank?
Yeah.
Like just, we're doing all this stuff just because we know the fans are going to like it. Like, it's not going to add anything to the story. It's just
Well, if you have a like basically a fan written movie for the most part, it's not going to sell toys.
Yeah.
It's going to be cool for the people that are really into Star Wars and really are about the continuity. But for the everyday person, it's going to lose them because they don't care about all those extra nerdy details.
Yeah, that's a good way.
I was going to say it might also be a good thing for like, especially because you did have a whole new generation of people who didn't watch the previous Star Wars films.
Mm-hmm.
It was something to get them excited about the earlier ones.
Because
mm-hmm. yeah. there's a bunch of like recurring references and stuff, so that when they do watch the episodes later, they're like, oh, this is so-and-so from episode 2.
Yeah. Whereas I guess like what you're saying with fan service, they would have been just all about references and stuff and things, a new generation. It wouldn't have been its own story. It would have been references.
But it would be fine if they're not like writing it themselves. But at least have like people to be like, eh, like, not what is it called?
They should have just had Stephen Colbert, who's a huge fan, just be like, look, is there stuff wrong with this? He would have been like, I love the story, but this and this and this is wrong. It's got to connect to that. Cool, done.
No, what's that thing where, you know, they get a bunch of people to like try out a new product and there's people behind the glass door listening to them?
The focus group?
Yeah, focus group.
They just had a Star Wars nerd focus group. They could have gotten some opinions and George Lucas would have been like, he did point out this good thing. I really don't like what he said about I should create this world full of like.
They don't have to take any of their opinions, but.
But he did point out this flaw. I should probably address it.
Yes.
But clearly, he told all his fans to go fuck themselves.
Yeah.
Which is why we're calling this
George Lucas Hates His Fans.
Yes.
We need to watch The People versus George Lucas. It's a prequel documentary that is apparently so bad, like in the sense that, like, there's a lot of following George Lucas around,
mm-hmm.
and at one point they're screening the movie to the executives, and the movie ends, and everyone's dead silent. Everyone's just like, there's no time to fix any of this. Like, they all realize, holy shit, this is not good, and they can't do anything about
it. That was episode, like...
In episode, I think, 1, when it was coming out. And even one of the writers is like, you can't have Qui-Gon dying and then cut to Jar Jar being silly. Like, they don't work type things. And at one point, George Lucas is like, the key to doing this is to not go overboard. And then the movie ends, and he's like, I think I went overboard. I think I did too much. Like, and then you have the realization that there's nothing they can do about it anymore. The movie has to go out. And they're just like, well, fuck.
Having said all that,
yeah,
I have very high hopes for episode 7. Yeah. Because it's not, and it's not even like, especially for me, because everybody else got to watch them, you know, when they happened. I kind of watched all the Star Wars movies already kind of knowing what happened.
Mm-hmm.
So these next 3 chapters, I have no idea. There's no spoilers.
It's not just you.
It's everyone. No one knows.
Yeah, but everybody got to experience that with the other movies, like when they saw them for the first time.
Mm-hmm.
Like, this is me.
This is
going to
be your first Star Wars movie where you don't know
anything. I don't know anything that's going to happen. Whereas when I watched all the past 6 in the past 2 months,
mm-hmm. yeah,
I kind of already knew, like, I already knew Leia and Luke were brother and sister. I already knew that Darth Vader was his father. Mm-hmm. And, like, even watching...
Spoiler alert.
Even watching 1 through 3, it's kind of like, I already kind of know what happens.
Mm-hmm.
So, I'm very excited about episode
7. Me too. No, I'm so excited.
That's why the marketing... I agree with the marketing for this movie completely. Because mm-hmm. we know nothing.
Yeah.
Good nothing job, important. Guys.
Good job, Sony. Not, I was going to say Sony. Disney.
And I just want everyone to follow suit, you know, with like the Marvel marketing and all that.
Yes, please stop
they
showing
spit
us
out
everything.
Like 4 trailers.
with all the storyline.
Always hard to resist.
Okay.
Yeah. But man, it's going to be so good. Can't wait.
Yes.
4 weeks away?
4 weeks?
Four.
Oh,
four,
shit.
Five and change. Four and change.
Sweet.
Already got our tickets.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And Kramer's going to make a rig so we can record in the car as we watch it in the drive.
I
got to
figure that
just
out.
Just kidding. Just kidding.
I am going to wear my Chewbacca onesie, though.
Nice.
Which is also something I'm very proud of, is that I've told Juan this
before.
You're
going to wear it to the premiere?
Huh?
You're going to wear it to the premiere?
I might. It might be very hot.
They're not going to want masks.
Oh, man. I was like, I should buy that Kylo Ren mask.
I don't have to wear masks.
Nope. Don't want that.
I can see that, though. too many shootings.
I was telling Juan before that I don't wear anything that I haven't watched the stuff for. Or, like, I don't know anything about. And mm-hmm. now I can finally buy Star Wars clothes.
Yeah.
Which makes me very happy. Which I actually like having.
He thinks he's earned it.
Aw, you're so
mean. Give me back the headphones.
No, I wasn't. You have.
You said I think.
Oh, he knows.
So, Kramer, earned. What about that Optimus Prime shirt you're wearing?
I know a little bit about the Transformers.
He just said a little bit.
I know
bit.
About Optimus. What? What about the Tron mashup?
To be fair,
that it is?
I didn't buy this.
You should know about Tron?
Yeah, you did.
No, it came in the loot crate.
You paid 20 bucks.
He's like, I know who Optimal Prism is.
Optimal Prism?
Optimal Prism?
Optimal Prism?
This is the bootleg version.
Yes. It's the one you find in the Hong Kong market.
Yeah,
it's the toy you get in Mexico.
He's just a car.
Spent a little too much time working in the flea market, Kramer.
Yeah.
That's it.
The trailer was great.
Oh, yeah. We have to talk about the new international trailer, if we have time.
Was there a lot that happened in it?
Yeah, what can we go into?
I mean,
we kind of went into all, because a lot of it was the same scenes from the...
They showed more Rey talking. She's waiting for her family. Maybe she's been abandoned.
Kylo said, I will fulfill
our destiny. Yes, that was a new added line.
I want to say that there's something with that staff that she has.
So do you think Kylo... I don't think Kylo is Luke.
No.
No, he said that he's not... He can't be Luke.
But it's just like...
Could be.
Because
he can't.
My brother and I have talked a lot about how they're going to take inspiration from books.
Mm-hmm.
Bits and pieces. Not adapt them, but in a lot of the books, Han Solo and Leia's children became
Jason?
The main players. Jason, Solo, and
I don't remember the girl.
I forget her name.
I read the thing too. I don't remember it.
But that might be Rey and Kylo.
Mm.
And maybe that's not their real names. Maybe they're Jason and.
Yeah, that'd be kind of cool. From what I've read, like, about that, if they did something similar.
So he might be Anakin's grandson.
Yeah.
Maybe Luke trained him.
Maybe. That's what I always figured. I was like, maybe he's got some kind of training, and he just decided he didn't need the rest of the training, and he left.
I think I've read somewhere that either JJ or someone said that his crossguard lightsaber, he's very good with it.
Oh,
because it takes more skill to use than just a normal one.
I can believe it. If you've seen the new TV spot, there's one thing of like new footage in there where he's blocking blasters with it,
mm-hmm.
and that's really cool. He's just doing it one handed, just
Yeah, see, I don't want to see stuff like that. I want to see that in the movie.
But then going back to the international trailer,
mm-hmm.
he has it up next to.
That's my Rey's favorite shot of the trailer.
Me too. And the TIE fighters coming in
mm-hmm.
with that like sun background looks so awesome. And then you see him turn on the lightsaber and what looks like the bridge of a starship.
Yeah.
So that's cool. Man, it just, not too much extra, but just enough that you're like, whoa.
When you were saying that you think that Luke might have trained him, so are you saying Luke did go to the dark side after 6?
No, I think Kylo went to the dark side.
I think I'm going to agree with what Tom was saying on one of the previous podcasts, that Luke did eventually turn to the dark side.
Not going to happen.
Can't do it either. I can't go with it.
You can't go with it?
Or you
don't want to go with it?
I
don't think so. It'd just be bad. In terms of even like writing, it just seems bad.
It doesn't make narrative sense based on how Return of the Jedi ended.
Because George Lucas changed it for fan service.
Exactly.
But still, but George that's is not what even, the story was.
Yeah.
No, but even then, like, what...
But he didn't write 6, so it wasn't even fan service.
But he still had the final say in, like, hey, if he goes evil, people aren't going to buy his shit.
I don't think that was even it, because if he turned evil, people would have still seen him as a
but even then,
person.
Luke still tried to kill the Emperor.
But the whole point was that he resisted himself.
No, he did.
I lost the word we're going.
Well, anyway, we were saying that I don't.
Luke is evil.
Luke is not evil. It alienates too many fans.
It doesn't have to
turn
to the dark side all at once. It could have just been like at the end of six, he starts the slippery slope towards the dark side.
I can't buy it.
No. Because there's a metaphor for him seeing Anakin. I guess Anakin was added later, but Yoda and Ben at the end of the movie. And I don't know. That was just such a light side moment, you know.
That doesn't mean he was completely gone from the light side.
Yeah.
But wouldn't they show Luke in the picture as far as, like, when they show Han and Leia?
Because it's a secret.
Given like, because from what they've basically, you know, revealed is the Force is a myth at this point to, you know, the newer generation of people. They don't think it's real.
And granted, even though episode one or the prequels came after six, it does kind of match up that it's the death of a parent that leads them to go down the dark side.
Yeah.
Like Anakin's mom dies, he's emotionally stressed. Luke finally meets his dad dies.
But his dad wasn't killed. His dad died sacrificing himself to save Luke. Why would he go against that and then become evil?
And by bringing balance to the Force.
Yeah.
Fulfilling the destiny
of the chosen one.
But that could still leave, you know, a lot of anger and such. Inside Luke.
I just think it alienates too many fans, one thing. I mean, Disney's not going to buy this property only to turn everything that everybody knows upside down.
I think they might, though.
No.
I don't think they would.
We'll find out.
It doesn't make any financial sense for them. Because
It's
Disney. They don't have to make financial sense.
They still
got to
make some money. They still have to make money.
Dude, no matter what they do, they're going to make money off of this. The prequel sucked, and they made a shitload of money.
But it's going to ruin for the rest of the movies. They're going to be like, well, this property's dead. They killed us with the prequels.
Jar Jar didn't kill the first three.
It has been proven.
Just because they still made the first three doesn't mean that it won't still ruin people from the next ones. They're going to come anyway because they know they're going to make some kind of money. Just like the Fantastic Four was so shitty, but they're going to keep making them.
It's been proven time and time again that a previous property can sully the perception of a future property that's in the same ballpark.
But it's also been proven that Disney can do literally anything they want.
Sure.
And it will sell billions.
I think that's just too big of an assumption still.
No, Disney can do whatever the fuck they want.
They can do what they want because they have money, but they still need something to keep bringing in money.
You don't think a surprise twist of Luke slaughtering all that was left of the Jedi?
You don't understand how many people...
I don't think you understand people are going to be mad at that.
Piss off so many people.
Yeah.
But already so many people are like kind of thinking that. It's not so much like it's just me and Tom that think this.
I think what we're talking about is exactly how it's split up, like, online. You got some people who are like, yes, but then you have
online
a lot of people that are like, no.
Online is a minority as well.
I think it's,
I don't know. Online, it's kind of the whole world.
I've never, to be honest, I've only read a couple comments on threads that have said, that have been, like, full on with that. A lot of people just are the same way. They won't do it.
Well, we'll see.
We'll find out.
We'll see. Yeah.
It'll be fun either way.
Okay. Yeah.
Next episode is episode 7.
No, we still got time. It'll be something else.
Yeah, we'll
well, in the miniseries.
Oh, yeah. We'll continue that in episode 7. In the meantime, I'm sure we'll have another episode of something else.
Yes.
We don't know what it is.
Yes. We will do it.
We should do an episode of Tommy Doesn't Know.
Tommy doesn't know, but we're going to tell him.
Stop trying to make up the theme song, Kramer. You've ruined it like 10 times. Every time you try to do it, it's always bad.
That's all I can think of in my head is every time you say that, though.
Well, we'll write something better.
Yeah.
All right. Okay.
Yay.
In the meantime, I'm Kramer.
I'm Ryan.
I'm Juan.
I'm Tom, sometimes.
Do it.
Looks
dark side.
Looks a good guy.
Unlimited.
Ow, my throat.
Unlimited power.
Yeah, I'm dying. I'm choking.
Are you force choking?
I'm force choking. I can only do that voice so long.